Good morning and welcome to the 18th meeting in 2022 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. Please note that we've received apologies from Willie Coffey, Annie Wells and Mark Griffin. And I would ask all members and witnesses to ensure their mobile phones are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. The first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take item 3 and 4 in private. Are we all agreed? We're all agreed. The next item on our agenda is to take evidence on the impact of the Community Empowerment Act on allotments and community food growing. This is the second of three evidence sessions the committee is holding during this current inquiry. We'll be discussing this topic today with two panels of witnesses representing local authorities together with the Association for Public Service Excellence, known as APSE. And our first panel that we're hearing from is Peter Duncan, who's the Allotments Officer at Fife Council, Paul O'Brien, who's the Chief Executive of the Association for Public Services Service Excellence, APSE, and Wayne Priestley, who's the Principal Advisor, also from APSE. We'll also be hearing from Ian Woolard, who's the Allotments Officer from Edinburgh City Council. And I welcome our witnesses to the meeting. Paul and O'Brien and Wayne Priestley are both joining us remotely today. And it would be helpful if members could direct their questions to a specific witness where possible, although I'll be happy to bring others in if they wish to contribute. And if witnesses do wish to comment, please indicate your desire to do so to me or the clerk, and I'll bring you in at an appropriate point. And I'd be grateful if Paul and Wayne, if you could indicate that you wish to come in by putting an R in the chat function in Blue Jeans. And I'll now open the session with questions from members, and I'm going to get things started. So I'm going to direct this to Peter. And then also, let me just check here, and also Paul. So, Peter, I'm interested to hear how much it costs to provide allotments and how have council budgets for allotments and community growing changed since the Act was passed in 2015?
The cost for allotments in Fife, it depends really on the area of land that we're looking at. And what surrounds that land, if it's already fenced and so forth, that's a major expenditure. It might be an existing wall garden, which we've got in Fife. But on an average, to provide in Fife a plot for a grower, provided with a 6x4 shed that keeps the planning people happy, and keeps the window frames and the sort of doors out of the equation, so it keeps it a wee bit tidier. That costs in the region, pre-COVID, was in the regions of £1,000 per plot. Now, that was an introduction to the fencing. There was a contribution to fencing and communal sort of resources, and the shed made up £400 of that. That had a water collection system on it as well, so obviously that's got a knock-on effect on the future maintenance bills. However, post-COVID, we could bet anything between £1,500 and £2,000 for the same facility, and that is crippling the projects at the present time.
Can I just clarify, so in Fife you provide a shed for people?
Yes, what we do in Fife is we had a discussion with planning officers. The biggest fear from elected members, and I go back 11, 12 years ago, was that we weren't building any more shanty towns, and that was their words. And so to satisfy planning, because some of our sites are within List B structures and so forth, that if we provided the shed, then that provided some continuity of structures across the site, but equally more importantly, it was a social leveller, because everybody that could come along have a wee shot at horticulture, and obviously the biggest expenditure there would be the shed. So what we'd have is we've got a pricing three-tier pricing structure in Fife. So per square metre, it's 45 pence a square metre, and that includes your shed. And the basics of it allows us over a 5-year period to refill and maintain that building with the extra income, because the average cost is 30 pence a square metre in Fife for stuff and a site without that individual shed.
Right. Okay. Thanks for that clarity. And Paul, I wonder if you've got a kind of bigger picture sense on the cost of allotments.
Yes. Thanks, Chair. I mean, what our figures are telling us at a UK-wide level, and we've monitored this over the last 15 years or so on surveying work with local authorities across the UK, the sort of most common price for a 250 square metre plot is around about £70 per annum. I think what the figures are showing us that over 50% of authorities are charging over £50 a plot per annum now. The other thing that we are seeing as well as in terms of costs is the ongoing rising costs, cost of living generally, I suppose, impact on inflation, etc. But we are seeing local authorities suggesting that over 40% of them suggesting that they intend increasing costs on an ongoing basis over the next 2 to 5 years, and another 32% are looking at reviewing those costs at present. So quite a substantial amount of those authorities looking to increase cost. That's as a result, obviously, of budgets continuing to tighten at a local authority level and the ability to subsidise plots on an ongoing basis diminishing. We've seen a long-term trend of a shift towards trying to break even on the provision of plots.
OK, so I think I might have missed something there. So that's the £50 per plot per annum is a charge to the plot holder. So then does that money go back into the provision of new allotments, or I'm just wondering how we actually, because I think one of the issues that we're beginning to understand here is that there's long waiting lists and not enough plots, and it's just how can we actually, what is the cost to actually provide allotments?
The cost there is for the maintenance and upkeep of the plots. What we're also seeing is an increase, as you've rightly pointed out, Convener, an increase in demand for plots. Local authorities responding to that by trying to increase the number of plots available. That sometimes is about repackaging the plots, smaller plots, etc., cutting them up in different ways, if you like, but also trying to find land, additional land, to create further plots. The cost that we're talking about is the cost to maintain those plots and allotments.
Okay, but we don't have any clarity around a budget for actually creating new allotments.
There's limited budgets that authorities have available for those allotments. They're not making surplus, if you like, from the upkeep costs. The upkeep costs are about trying to break even. They're still subsidising those. New plots sometimes come from developers as well, new developments, housing developments, etc. There's evidence around that suggests that's a further way of providing those new plots. But local authorities themselves looking to repurpose land and increase the number of plots available. We've actually seen some evidence that that the waiting lists, although there's an increase in demand, the waiting lists now are starting to diminish just a little bit. They're starting to improve, and it's not as long wait. That's right across the board. We're not talking about individual authorities here. We're talking about there's that increase in demand, but the waiting time seems to be reducing just a bit.
Okay, thanks for that. Ian, you wanted to come in.
Yes, I think, as Peter says, I think the costs of the plots in Edinburgh is probably a little bit higher just now. I mean, I'm going on the assumption of the proposed extension at Victoria Park. That's 16 plots and a few raised beds, and that's just over 50,000. So we could be looking about as high as £3,000 per plot for that location. But different locations, different areas of the city, but Costs, certainly in Edinburgh, we do charge a little bit more extra for our plots. I mean, the proposed fees for next year are £138.50 for a full plot. So that's probably quite expensive, you know, it could be the most expensive in Scotland. But certainly the waiting lists, I wouldn't say they're diminishing, I'd say they're certainly increasing, especially here in Edinburgh anyway, and it's not showing any signs they're going away at all.
And that £130.50, is that kind of more than is needed to, so you use that for maintaining?
We do, but
is there anything there that you can actually put towards new plots? Or does that pretty much cover it?
Probably any new plots are coming from capital money, right. Which of course the council is going to incur a debt long term on that cost. But problem in Edinburgh, the income we can generate from allotments is just over 100,000. So probably as a one-man service, we probably break just about even on the revenue costs and the day-to-day running, which is probably quite pleasing to my bosses.
Okay. Okay. Oh, okay. I've just heard, Wayne, you'd like to come in as well.
Yes, thank you. Just a point on the cost of allotment plots and what people charge per allotment plot. It often depends on the facilities that are on the site. So you can have an absolute blueprint site that's got water, electricity, all the facilities on the community huts, composting toilets, you name it. So you can have a five-star allotment plot, but a lot of the sites are quite small sites. So that £70 average that we are seeing in ours can reflect a site that is basically just a plot of land and nothing else. So that's why you get such variation. I understand with the Edinburgh one, that probably is a premier site, I would think, at those sort of prices with lots of those facilities on. But interestingly, from our report, what it is showing is that 50% of local authorities are subsidising the cost of allotments, and probably about 45% are just about breaking even. So there isn't any money in sort of providing allotments. It very much falls down to, do the council have the resources available to do it? And a lot of councils now are actually saying, well, we can't afford new sites. So what we will do, we'll look at the size of the existing plots we have, and we'll consider halving them, quartering them. They're actually going to people who've got multiple plots and saying, look, we are desperate for sites, we need more plots, can we have some of your plots back? Because historically people have had 2, 3, 4 plots. They're actually looking at digging some of the paths up in some cases, or reducing the size of the composting storage area to get new plots in. So there are all sorts of ways that they're looking to try and keep the cost of providing more allotments down by utilising what they currently got. And a lot of the new plots are smaller, and it's because the families are coming onto them and saying, well, we don't want massive football pitch size plots. We just want enough to feel we're getting a healthy lifestyle, involving the children, getting some homegrown products. So they don't always have to be new sites, I think, is probably what we're seeing from our results.
Thanks very much for that. And you kind of actually started to touch into an area I wanted to explore a little bit about, around the main barriers. And I think we are like kind of beginning to pull that out. But I mean, clearly allotments provide a lot of benefit for people, not just food. And I think last week in our last session, we kind of touched on the mental health and well-being aspects of it. So it's coming out already in the conversation this morning that barriers are really around cost, I think, it seems to be the main barrier. Is identifying sites also an issue?
I think with regard to the sites, it's getting better. The recognition from a local authority perspective, I think it's about the senior officers within other departments within the council recognising what the importance of community growing is and what it brings to the table, especially through the last 2 years that we've had, and the importance of that. I think based on what Wayne was saying there with regard to the realignment of things, I think we've got to be very careful that we don't go into a chopping up exercise and we're left with postage stamps. So in Fife we operate sort of 3 sizes, which allows people to go up the way or down the way internally if they so wish, if their circumstances change. But equally The biggest hurdle that we've got is people not knowing what to do. And then the Act, there's a bit mentioned about training. And that's something that sort of flies under the radar with everybody. So they're all very good at creating these kitchens that for cooking stuff, but if you can't grow it, you can't cook it. So that's the way it works.
Absolutely. Very, very good point. Can I just... So you've identified... I wanted to clarify around it. So you say three sizes in five. Could you just say a little bit more about that?
Yes. The recognised size per the Act is 250 square metres.
Yes.
However, if I put hand on heart and I said to you that anything we've got at that level or above is probably about 10% of our total supply.
Yeah.
We've found that 200 square metres, 100 square metres and even down to 50 square metres is more than suffice. If you think about 50 square metres and a single person, that is enough to supplement. You're never going to replace the food chain, you're going to supplement the food chain. And that's enough for them to manage. And I think the biggest hurdle, as we've found as well, is that people coming in, they've got to build up their horticultural skills, but also their time management, because the weeds don't stop, which gives Ian and I a sore head with the disciplinary side. So I think it's about, you know, not being too prescriptive. And I tend to look at our sites as a bespoke per the community. So if we could get the community bought in. Important thing we've mentioned about is, and we've mentioned it, touched it slightly, about waiting lists. I'm a great believer we're about to embark on cleansing our waiting list, because it was mentioned there about allotments, the peak going back. They certainly did peak. I think Ian would agree with me here, at the start of COVID, everybody thought they would have a growing space, and I've now called our waiting list expressions of interest, because when we go back and we're actually at some of our sites are at that level, the people have moved on, they've found something else to do. So that I think we're a wise move to analyse actually what our demand is. So by the end of this year, we will be in a position to do that.
Right.
So I think we find that the three sizes works well, and as people get older and the family moves off, they could downgrade, or their circumstances prevail as well. I think we've got to take all that into account.
Yes, I think that's a really good point. And I think we heard last week from Lou Evans, who talked about having starter plots for people as well, so that people aren't overwhelmed by the 250 square metres is equivalent to a tennis court or something, like singles tennis court, which can be quite a lot if you don't have horticultural skills.
What you'll find is I look upon the whole thing as stepping stones. So the Act covers allotments. However, everything from the floral enhancement on the corner of the street to the community garden to the allotment site is all important. Because it's gaining people's confidence and working outdoors and bringing. They might decide to get off the bus at the community garden stage and find that they're committing enough time as it is, and they're getting enough surplus produce from that. Equally, we've got into the mix. We've got a lot beside the allotments. We've got orchards and things chucked into the equation as well. And now we've got people looking at the next stage up from allotments. So effectively. Crofting in a sense, or small holding sort of size, community growing in a different way.
Yeah.
So it all brings different permutations to the table financially for the authority and how we're going to deliver that.
Yeah, absolutely. So exciting times for local growing in all kinds of manners. And we've got the Good Food Nation Bill, which is another piece that we've got to put together with all of the local food strategies. But Wayne, I think you wanted to come in... on this.
Yes, it's very much, Peter's covered a lot of what I was going to say, but I think he's right. I think the critical point to allotments is the education of people when they're taking on an allotment. What we're actually finding is, and I agree with Peter again about, you know, not cutting them up into small pieces just for the sake of it, but what we are finding is some of these larger plots, good percentage of the area is uncultivated because people just haven't got the time or the horticultural skills to completely, you know, use that plot totally. that's one of the reasons why they're being reduced. And a lot of people are saying they do want to try it out and see how it works, because time is the essence. You've got to put the time in to make the allotment work. And with there being such huge waiting lists, we don't want people sort of playing around with allotments if they're not going to take it seriously. So I was just backing up from what Peter was saying, really.
Thanks very much. And I think Paul wanted to come in as well.
Thank you. Just to reiterate those points about the challenges about availability of land, availability of green space, engagement about security is another issue as well, and that increasing demand, obviously. But I wanted to make a point about that, the uncultivated land, and just to say that, you know, that isn't allowed by local authorities to continue for too long. The evidence we've got is almost 80% taking action within 3 months. At the latest, if plots remain uncultivated. That's not draconian in any way. It's just actually the reality of it, that, you know, there's a staged process. We encourage people, first of all, if they've actually got the plot, to cultivate the land. And if they've not got it, you know, if they're not doing that, then once it sort of starts to hit the three-month point, the trigger points start to ratchet up to actually encourage them to use the land or hand it back.
That's very helpful. Did you want to come in, Ian?
Yeah, it's, I do try something quite unique here in Edinburgh. You know, generally when people have been waiting so long in their allotments and they finally get their plot, I make it a point of actually meeting every one of these new plot holders. And why I do that is, first of all, I show them the plot. And this is because some people, if they haven't had an allotment before and it's new to them, they can either be quite surprised how big a plot is or how small it is. So I make it a point of actually meeting them and say, look, go through the rules and regulations with them. And I'll say to them, you know, is this plot size okay for you? So I kind of feel it's quite important to do that, because then they know in their mind how much if they're going to do that plot. And of course, if they can't do the plot, I'm going to soon find out when I do my site visits at this time of the year, as the plots are starting to get a little bit grassed over and things like that. And that's when the emails start and the letters start. And then sometimes we're into conflicts, which is always an interesting part of this job. So I'm always trying different strategies to make it work. But that's just something I do just, generally, probably maybe about 100 plots a year change hands, you know. And I would say most of the new plot holders that come in are quite successful, because they've actually seen what they're actually getting. That's my experience anyway.
That's great. I think it's really important to do that kind of hand-holding and an initial introduction, understanding where people are at. And I guess what's coming up in general is maybe we need to think more about that kind of starter plot. It's clearly a desire in people to grow, to put seeds in the ground and grow food and have that connection. And maybe, yeah, we can need to look at it another way, but I think we've got that coming through the community garden movement as well. I just wanted to touch on two things, and I'm going to bring in colleagues for another for other questions. One is, Peter, you were mentioning when we kind of started to talk about barriers, you were saying that you were actually finding that barriers are coming down in terms of colleagues within the local authority recognising the importance of allotments. So which departments do you think are the allies in terms of allotment coming to fruition?
Surprisingly enough, estates is quite keen to work with us. And what we're doing is we did a repurposing our existing assets. So, for example, if we've got Green Desert, and that's costing X amount of pounds for to cut the Green Desert, what we're looking at is, can we turn that into community growing space? Yes, okay, we've got a capital expenditure on the asset. However, as the rent structure sits at the present time, I say that tongue-in-cheek because the prices are always going up, but that's covering, as was mentioned earlier, the ongoing costs, i.e. because we still have to pay for commercial rates for water. Mm-hmm. We've got a legal obligation to control potato blight. So if we've got potato blight on site, it involves putting a skip in for to take that away and green waste sort of stuff. So in the main, if we're repurposing sites, if you think about it, we're taking the maintenance cost as a saving. We're maybe spending One site that springs to mind was in Glenrothes. It was £1,400 a year to cut the grass with no purpose, except for motorcycles and things like that. £70,000 to create the site, and with an income of £3,500 per annum coming in from that site. So basically, we've still got the crown jewels, but the knock-on effect for the community is tenfold. Because if we've got 50 plot holders on a site, I think I could work roughly about 25 to 30% off other people are affected by that site in a good way. Whether it be that they're getting fresh produce from that site and it's the next door neighbour, we're getting half a cabbage or whatever it may be. So that's the benefits of the whole project in my mind. And then we've got obviously the social inclusion and so forth as well. And that's where I think that when we're doing a survey, we're going to be asking questions such as, OK, you're on a long waiting list. However, would you like to engage with a local community growing group in the meantime? Because if you think about it, Scotland-wide, allotment waiting list is the only horticultural list that exists. And so it's a bit of a sort of a bucket for everybody's interest. And so if we could filter that, and we could keep these people, instead of sitting on the waiting list for 5-6 years, we keep their interest moving, then eventually they might decide that's enough for them and they'll just move on, or they'll hang in there. Yeah. But equally, what we're doing is we're providing support to the community groups, because that's a thing that's been recognised in Fife as well, that we've got over 60 communities were involved in floral enhancements and stuff. However, that stopped because of COVID. And the thing with that was that there wasn't the recognition how important that was. So we're looking at kicking that back into action again. So basically, as I said earlier, it's not just about the statutory bit, it's about the bolt-on bits round about that yeah. Where Lou and Karen and so forth come from, with Grow Green Scotland and so forth.
Yeah, absolutely. Now that's very interesting. Ian, I just wonder if you've got any thoughts. You know, so Peter's identified estates as being a useful department that's kind of come online and recognised the importance of allotments. In Edinburgh, are there any other departments that...
Yes, planning have been quite helpful. Certainly, I'm just reflecting on our planning gain we got at New Craig Hall. That was Barrett's Homes that built many family homes out just at New Craig Hall there. And we managed, as a planning gain, to get basically a 26-plot site off them free of charge, which was nice. And obviously that's benefiting the local community there as well. On top of that, we're at this moment doing an extension at Leaf Links, just behind the existing Leaf Links, the rope works there. And S1 Homes have created a very nice, probably around about a 16-plot extension the time I split it down the middle. And I think they spent a little bit more money on that site than they were envisaging, but it keeps us happy and it keeps the plot holders happy. I think in terms of what we're also looking at as well is bowling greens in Edinburgh, which are maybe not being used at the moment. That seems to be kind of potential growth area for new sites for us. But some of that's slightly complicated because of the common good element on it. But fingers crossed we can get over that, and in the next number of years we'll see a number of bowling greens turned into allotments.
That's a really great idea for repurposing, and they've already got fences or hedges
around them.
So you don't have to worry about that, and probably also facilities.
And a water supply.
Exactly, yeah, great. I'm going to move on and just ask a question around, so maybe this is to Paul or Wayne from APSE. Do you have any understanding if councils actually measure the benefit of allotments or other community growing provisions? And kind of track the impact on other policy areas? Wayne, you look like you want to come in.
Yeah, sorry. I'm not aware of anybody that actually tracks in a measurable manner the impact it's having. But what I think is interesting is a lot of local authorities are now writing the provision of allotments into local plans, health and wellbeing strategies. And as you were mentioning there before, biodiversity strategies, climate change, sustainable urban drainage is being built into some allotment plots. And it's this whole thing about the multiplicity of benefits that allotments bring. And I think the other thing as well about partners is I certainly developed quite a large allotment site in Salford in Greater Manchester through the help of the health providers. And they were very keen from the point of view that they see it as a front-end way to sort of improve health and well-being, better food. The other option is things like the police for antisocial behaviour, because you get a lot of intergenerational work going on allotment. And you will find that there are many partners out there who are willing to help develop allotment plots. But as to actually anybody measuring it, I'm not aware of that. But it's something we could certainly try to find out.
Thanks for that. Yeah, I think it would be good to start measuring and really understanding how important growing spaces, community allotments or community growing spaces are. Let's move on onto another theme, which is around the impact of the allotment and maybe allotment, the Act on allotment demand and provision, but maybe we've covered some of that. I'm going to bring in Miles Briggs.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thanks for joining us today. I wanted to specifically ask a few questions with regards to Part 9 and how you think that's made a difference. And maybe start by asking to what extent the number of plots and sites has changed over the last 7 years. You've already touched upon some of the splitting which taken place. We've heard already from witnesses around some of the assessment of waiting lists, talking about a third, a third, a third, and just wondered how Part 9 has actually meant things have changed on the ground. I'll maybe start with yourself, Peter, and if anyone else wants to come in.
Well, Part 9, Ian, myself and Sandy was heavily involved for a long, long time. And I think what we are the doers, if you know what I mean, but I could see from a Scotland perspective, I could see where the rest of the other authorities are starting to waken up. And going away back many, many years ago, there was quite a few people engaged at the start, but then it started to wane off for quite a bit. And really, you were left with maybe four or five local authorities that were still actively wanting to engage up leading up to the Act. And especially after 2015, heading into the secondary guidance stuff that was being brought together, that was a bit protracted. And obviously we know that came in March 18. And I think out there on the front line, the cold faces, we'll call it, I think there was a lot of third sector organisations seeing the Act as a possible opportunity for to get the big stick out and bash the local authorities. And I think that mindset sort of still sits there to an extent. And there's not what I would say a full understanding of the impacts that we've got financially and otherwise, staffing resources and whatever else. Within the authorities. Now, in 2009, when I came into post, we were sitting with 13 sites in Fife. We've now 39 sites. So, and there's still only one of me. And as I say, so there's a wee bit of recognition needs to go, and I think the Act's helped that a wee bit within the internal management structures within the councils. It's not got there yet by any means. There's still distinct lack of staff and resources. As Ian said there earlier, about you still need that personal touch. It's people we're dealing with here. It's no tins of beans or anything. And I think we've also got to take into account that our client base has changed a lot in the last 10 years. We've got a lot more women, children, whatever else on site. So there's been the need for to have a change in facilities as well. And so, you know, not all our sites, but the majority of our sites have got toilets and so forth, and maybe a meeting room and so forth like that. So yes, there's benefits came out of it, but for the, I'll say it tongue in cheek, from the uneducated, not knowing what's going on within the local authorities, that's what the problem is. Is they're reading what the Act says, the secondary guidance says, but they're not on the cold face actually understanding the problems that Ian and I's got on a day-to-day basis, whether it be aggression or whatever, because there's a weird and wonderful bunch that's out there called allotment holders. And some of it, we say tongue-in-cheek again with the cultivation side of it, we've been challenged, we've been in the court, but people with no dig policies and wanting to grow dandelions and stuff like this, everybody's got their own opinion of what they want to do. And I think, you know, we can't be too prescriptive on it, but equally, but from a local authority perspective, we've still got to have the rules and regulations that tie in with what legal says and what planning says and whatever else. But yes, as I say, there's been good bits, there's bad bits, there's some misunderstanding of the Act, especially surrounding waiting lists, which I get that quite regular. Why we've not done anything about the waiting lists? Well, with the thresholds, well, there's a honeymoon period there that was built in for the local authorities. To be honest with you, that's something that maybe needs to get seriously looked at, because of the desire now as human beings for to go outside into green space and to grow. So are we going to manage to meet these? Probably not. And whether it be financial or otherwise. And it's something that's maybe an opportune moment with a review going on is to actually look at that. You want to say any more about that, Ian?
Well, I have a, how to top that, what you're saying, Peter, you know. But certainly, I would say in my 30 years of managing allotments for the City Council, I've seen quite a few changes, you know. I think when I started it in 1992, I think we only had something like 17, 18 sites. So now we're up to 32, as in 2020. But I would say, probably like Peter, you know, we've embarked on quite a big new allotment sites. I mean, certainly it's in Edinburgh since 2011 we built many. I think maybe to bear in mind is that they're not the big sites we already have, such as Inverleaf. These new sites we're getting now, they're fairly small ones. I mean, obviously, I mean, if we were to do a site such as Inverleaf, you're looking at a cost of hundreds of thousands, and that's going to be a debt that the council is going to incur for many years to come. But yeah, it's been an interesting job, you know. I'm always keen to try and, you know, always looking for new sites and how do we better manage the existing stock we've got. And but as Peter says, it's always full of challenges, you know.
Thank you for that. I wanted to, and you've touched upon this already in the sense of how the Act has been interpreted by local authorities. Now, obviously, you two are the living embodiment of the councils you are working in for around allotments. But we know, for example, in Highland Council, they do not run or allocate sites despite having large waiting lists for private sites in the Inverness area. So you touched upon, Peter, that honeymoon period. Has that prevented people in local authorities needing to act on this, needing to think about these waiting lists which have built up because they've seen this as something coming rather than something they had to do something about now?
I think, I know that I've spoken to various local authorities for advice. I think what's happened is there's been a lot of staffing changes within these local authorities, and over the years, since 2015, there has been a lot of change. I mean, we're probably, Sandy and myself and Ian's probably the diehard among them. But what I found was that there was, usually if the phone goes or I get an email wanting advice on tenancy agreements or whatever, some of them come through our estates department or directed us and wondering how they work with leases and things. So Murray Council was one of them. But I think we've also got people who are, I wouldn't say they've used that as an excuse, we'll put it that way. I think that what we've got is we've got a lot of officers being put into positions without the experience that's sitting behind them, and the lack of support. And it comes in, to be quite frank about it, comes right back to this building, because if you phoned up today and got in, and sort of phone Ian or phone Peter, then they'll help you. So it needs to be a go-to for these people. And some of them are right in at the deep end, and equally they've got third sector groups biting at their back saying, you must provide this, you must do that, you must do the next thing, and quoting every piece of the act possible. But this poor individual doesn't have that backbone, and that's where they're possibly coming back to Ian or myself for a bit of advice. And I didn't mind doing that. I mean, I didn't want to be seeing anybody falter with the thing. But that person tends to be the lone individual within the authority, and it's about them getting their authority officers to start thinking along the same lines as possibly Ian's does or I do. So there's a whole, we went on about education and horticulture, never mind that, there's the education side of it sitting within the authority structure. So I think, you know, to me, the act arrived on the doorstep. Did it make a big difference to me? No, really, because we were involved in it that much and we knew what was coming in a sense. But for someone picking it up green on day one, it's quite a daunting thing to say, well, what about this and what about that? And as I say, there's some organisations out there and some potholders who are sort of keen to just keep pushing and pushing and pushing without actually just taking time. It takes me about 3 years by the time of inception to delivery on the ground. Because there's no sense in delivering an allotment site in the middle of July, for example, and it's going to, nobody wants it. They want your better timing it so that they're getting ready for the start of the growing season. So going right back to your question, I think that it would be good if the government could facilitate some sort of support to the local authorities, officers, whether it be through the tripartite working group that we've already discussed, that Ian and Sandy and I sit on, and try and just be there for the one-stop shop, or it's maybe administers through APSE or something like that direction. So hopefully that answers, helps to answer.
Does anyone else want to come in on that? Or I think we've covered quite a lot of points there. I wanted to just finally ask with regards to, and you touched upon this as well, with individuals who potentially don't want a full-size allotment but want to start growing, and community growing especially, and just wondered how that has been assessed, to look at demand, especially coming out of the pandemic when I think people did want that space, and how a different model maybe is needed for, you know, we've seen on some of the visits we've done, raised beds being provided for people, or just a small space to see whether or not you're going to be sustainably able to manage a site, and how that's maybe something which could be developed on new sites, to really allow that community to develop of people who would all be in the same position of trying to start out.
We our survey that we've done during COVID, if anything good came out of COVID, we managed to change our IT systems so that we could now contact everybody on our waiting lists. Now, that's always been a big hurdle for local authorities in the past. So we're now able to contact the 1,800 people we've got sitting on the list. And we intend to start for first stage surveys to ask them what they want. So we could zone that down right back into postcodes and into communities. So if it was Auchtermuchty, for example, there was a desire in Auchtermuchty for a community garden and an orchard, that's the road we go. So we're basically providing the community what the community's desires are, rather than just working on, so well, there's in the set area, there's demand. Now, at present time, we only know that demand because of the existing sites and the waiting lists. But these existing sites, there could be anybody on that waiting list from wherever, you know. And sometimes people put their names on multiple lists, and which gives you a wee bit of false figures as well. So I think going forward, our method of delivery is obviously very much community-led and officer-supported. And this survey, the initial survey, allows us to do that. Then, from the people who identify that allotments as number one for them, they will then be further surveyed along with the existing plot holders, which will then shape our new allotment strategy, which is coming in 2023-24.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. If I could just add to that, certainly in Edinburgh, we certainly know where our demand is, especially EH5, 6, 4, 9 and 10. Big, massive waiting list. I mean, certainly at the moment, our waiting list is currently, I was starting to look at it the other day, there was about 5,600. Now, 2019, we had 3,000 people on that list, so as we were the cleanse of the waiting list, we asked people to validate if they wanted an allotment. So that took it down to 1,290. Now, obviously, I don't think anybody's seen the pandemic coming. That's gone back up to over 5,500. But my kind of concern is, obviously, Edinburgh land's definitely a premium. You know, EH6, not much land really in Leith for new plots. 9 and 10, Morningside. But it's a challenge, you know. There's no question about it. But how do we get that land where we can actually put new sites on? It's always been my concern.
Thank you. Thanks, Karina.
Thanks, Miles. I'm now going to bring in Marie McNair.
Thank you, Karina. Good morning, panel. It's great to see you this morning. My first question really was kind of already covered about the kind of more joined-up approach to provision of growing spaces, but just going back on Ian's point there, I mean, how often do you review your waiting lists within Edinburgh?
The last time we reviewed it was March 2019, so we're probably coming up for review again. You know, so obviously the quickest way to do that would be to contact those on the waiting list by email. Because as Peter probably says, how many people did apply for allotments during the pandemic thinking this is a nice thing to do? But yeah, it's a bit of a worry, the waiting list, you know, and how it keep rising. I mean, because we've got an online process as well, it makes it much easier for people. Pre-online, people had to do it the old-fashioned way, they had to phone me up. And then I was sending out an application form. So that kind of held at about 350 a year. Now, if I look at the figures from last year, that's about 1,300 people applied. So whenever you make it slightly easier for people, they always take the easy route.
What about yourself, Peter? I mean, do you review it on an annual basis? Or?
No, unfortunately not. Ours is on a quarterly basis. We're challenged with putting reports back on a quarterly, performance figures back on a quarterly basis for plot allocation and the waiting lists. So every quarter I've got to justify what we're doing, whether it's if they've went up, why they've went up and what we're doing to do it, which is works in my favour immensely because it's given the elected members a good picture of what's going on and senior management. We're saying, well, you know, we have got a climb here. But what we've found is, as I say, we mentioned this new system, we've found that we could go into that and we could pick out the duplications as well, which, as Ian says, it's quite easy just to just tick the box and fill it in. And I think that's where it's going to be an interesting exercise when we go through what we're going to go through just shortly. And the last time we did that was when about 2 years after I came into post to establish the real demand before I started building sites. And we lost over 50% of these people that was on paper lists and whatever. But we didn't bin them, we put them to the side just so we made sure that they were, if they came back, and some of them did come back at a later date. But on a quarterly basis, it's quite interesting to see how the figures go. And equally, when you drill down into that, It reflects back on employment issues as well. For example, if we've got a major employer in that area, for example, in Glenothis, when Tillis Russell's shut the door, that had a major impact on my waiting list because people were an age where they'd worked there all their days, but they were 50 odd year old, so they weren't going back into mainstream employment again, but they had time on their hands, so they wanted an allotment. And so there was a wee bit of fallout from there. So if you keep your eye on the sort of that side of things as well, and people sort of tend to miss that a wee bit with things.
I think Paul wants to come in on this as well.
I think Ian as well.
I'm very impressed if Peter does it quarterly. Well done, Peter. My worry is if I suddenly, but from a selfish point of view, if I suddenly contact 5,500 people, ask, do you still want an allotment, etc., my inbox, my email is going to explode for the next month. So all I'm going to be is sitting at the desk answering emails, because you'll be guaranteed people always want to know where am I on the list. So we do need to do a validation quite soon. How are we going to do that? I'm still trying to figure that out.
Okay. You wanted to come in.
Yes, just on that point of waiting lists, what we have been told by the people we survey, of which there's over 150 local authorities that we've surveyed on this from across the UK, about 90% of them are regularly updating their waiting lists. I take that as within an annual basis at the latest. That's to remove people who are no longer interested or who've moved away from the area. Other interesting statistics for it, from it perhaps as well, is that 71% of those responding are saying that they restrict availability of plots to people who live in that local authority area. And only 21% these days are allowing plots to be passed on to family members. There's just a few statistics there around about how people manage those waiting lists as well. Thanks.
A wee question. Are you aware of other parts of the 2015 Act being used to enable community growing for allotment purposes, for example, asset transfer and participation requests? Can you give any examples of these in your authorities? And I'll go back to Peter and Ian, if that's okay.
We have found that we've had one or two requests about community asset transfers. However, obviously that has a knock-on effect back to the local authorities. So if I was to do a CAT transfer, and given the Act only applies to land owned by or leased by the local authority, what it means is that effectively that is out of the equation for reporting purposes and otherwise. So if we put out a site, say it was 100 plots, all of a sudden I've lost 100 plots in my equation. Equally, in Fife we have got quite a few, especially in sort of Dalgetty Bay or Scythe area, there's private sites. And the only contact that we have with them, we had plenty of contact during COVID with them, but prior to that, they tend to be, just as they say on the tin, their private sites, they operate their own waiting lists and whatever else. At the time, there was a great big discussion went on about the inclusion of private sites into the Act, and that answer we ended up was that they weren't included. I felt personally they should have been included, because if we as a local authority are doing a report back to the government, and we're saying here is the demand in the area, and you so happen to have in a given area a lot of private sites, it's not a true reflection. Mm-hmm. Far from it. So that's where we are. The CAT transfer thing, I can't say that the groups are overly keen to take that on, because there is absolute pitfalls in there. We joke about the sort of allotment wars, but there are real allotment wars. And even where we've got sites that are out on leases, the lease is written in such a way that so the individual lease is mirrors our direct managed lease, except the name has just changed. But then that's mirrored into the main lease for the site. So the default position really is the council, because we own the land. And we've had to do it on occasion where the group felt that they couldn't manage because it's too personal. It's like, because the secretary is usually, and the chairman's, they're also plot holders. It's too personal to deal with things. and it's got to the stage where the plot holders basically not doing their plot. And how it's written is if their lease goes into default, it puts the main lease into default. However, the group's not then challenged by the council. The council, like myself, stand by the group and bring in our resource, i.e. the legal services, to deal with it, because where's the group going to get that backup? And that's the disadvantages of like so doing a community asset transfer on out there, because what you will end up with is, you know, I've probably on more dartboards than Fife than people could imagine, but what you'll end up with is you'll end up with unmanaged, unruly sites. And it sounds bad, but that's a real hard fact of the matter, is when you get strong individuals in there who don't want to play ball, then there has that, unfortunately, there still has to be some sort of rules and regulations that you've got to have. And that's where the groups don't have the teeth for to deal with that or the resources. And the amount of times that I've had secretaries who've resigned because of the amount of grief that they know, I'm just wanting to come along and do my allotment plot. I don't want the grief that goes with it. So we've got quite a mixture in Fife where we've got direct managed sites, we've got private owned sites, and we've got sites that are managed through groups, and then we've got leased ones as well. So hopefully that answers your question a bit.
Yep.
I don't have a lot of experience with community asset transfer. That's mostly some of my housing colleagues. They're doing quite a lot, particularly in the land in Edinburgh. It's on the housing revenue account. As I say, most of the sites in Edinburgh are directly managed, so I don't have a lot of experience of the community asset transfer. I'm sorry.
Paul, do you want to come in? Maybe add anything further to that?
Sorry, yeah, it's just probably supporting what Peter said. Well, we all the evidence we see is that there's an ongoing need, even where there's committees in place that are managing sites, there's a need for ongoing subsidy, support, skills, help, you know, that sort of umbilical cord back to the local authority. You know, all of the survey work that we've done over the years shows that that's important, and it continues to be important, and in many ways it's increasing. Some of the groups struggle to survive on their own, if you like.
That's me. Give it a
thanks very much. I'm now going to bring in questions from Paul McLennan.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. My constituency is Lothian, which has probably got the longest waiting time in the whole of Scotland, so it's an interest, to myself. And I think the previous panel talked about there's a community garden in Dunbar, and there's also an allotment, which was kind of done not through the council, but kind of private. An arrangement sort of thing, so that there's been a problem with that. The question I was going to kind of ask is talking about waiting lists and trigger points, and you've kind of touched on some of these already and mentioned around about waiting times, which I think you've both mentioned. I suppose the key thing is, could this information be tracked nationally? And probably the first point, Ian, that's for yourself in that regard, and probably bring up to you in that regard, because the second part of that question is really talking around about benchmarking in terms of where councils are. Now, I know it's not apples for apples and whatever, but I just wondered, Ian, if you wanted to comment on that, and in particular in regards to the information being tracked nationally. I mean, can you assess where you are in terms of other local authorities, for example, and is that a useful exercise, if that was the case?
Do you know what? It would be a useful exercise. I'd love to know where Edinburgh stands compared to the rest of the country, waiting list-wise. I'd imagine some of the London boroughs would have huge waiting lists as well. Any kind of built-up area or built-up city's got to have big waiting lists, you know. So for me, it would be a great benchmark to have, and it'd be useful to see where the demand is. I'm sure there must be some local authorities out there where the waiting list is quite low. I think I remember years ago when Peter and I used to have all these meetings with the various local authorities. I think it was about 4 years ago, I think Clackmannanshire had about 16 people on the waiting list, you know, so it's quite a, it's probably quite a varied around the country, so it would be interesting, actually.
Yeah,
Peter, I don't know if you want to come on that, and then I'll bring APSE in, and I think probably from the point of APSE, obviously, is a benchmark in comparing it with different types of councils as well.
Different
size of council.
I think we, at the tripartite working group that Tracy heads up, that's been on the go for a long time. And what was discussed there was that we've got, in Scotland, we've got local authorities with different requirements. So we've got to take into account what their geographics is. So we've got the smaller local authorities with smaller areas. We've got Fife, which is fishing in one and mining in the sort of west and fishing in the east and then sort of Newtown in the middle. And what we looked at was a possibility of kind of problem solving was looking at matching local authorities in, so the Highlands and Borders maybe, and Highlands and Dumfries and Galloway. They've got very similar problems with sort of remote settlements that might require different things. And if you go back to the Act, it says about provision of 5 miles radius or half an hour on public transport or whatever it is. However, you can imagine trying to apply that in the Highlands. And the same down in Dumfries and Galloway or the Borders as such. And I think where we were, and correct me if I'm wrong, Ian, but where we were thinking was that it was like a buddy kind of system, which probably could be a potential answer to a lot of the questions that probably you've got in your mind. And I think, from my point of view, I think that, you know, there's no sense in another authority falling down the hole that once fell down before. And so let's not reinvent wheels here. And everybody's there for the same purposes, to grow food, for social inclusion, whatever else it may be. And I think where we are is, I think that, you know, paperwork's fine, but the practical know-how and sort of, well, don't worry about that, that'll be okay. That's what's required. And so there's a steadying hand on the shoulder, in a sense, to people out there. I think there was a lot of opportunists, and there still is, out there in the private sector, who have looked at the provision of growing space attached to the size of, no mentioning names, but attached to the side of garden centres and things like that, and charging extortionate rates for them. I think what we've also got to bear in mind there is, and it goes back to the most important thing, is it's affordability for all. So if we're looking at our and Fife, if we're looking at all the sort of people that live in Fife, well, everybody should be on the level playing field for accessibility to that. And sometimes in Fife we've got imbalance where we've got severe areas of deprivation balanced against sort of, well, St Andrews is a good example, where we have severe deprivation in one part of St Andrews and very affluent in the other, and neither will mix. But what I'm saying to them is, well, as an officer, I'll treat everybody the same. We're on the same page here. And I think that's what we've also got to be careful of, that we don't make things, if we're looking at any change, we help the local authorities to administer that, yourselves do that, and we then in turn could support the group. So, as I say, there's been a lot of discussion going on in the tripartite group about how that could happen, where it could happen financially, so that the groups, if they're wanting to start up a grown site, gets a financial sort of start-up grant or a seed corn grant.
Come on to that point. You're coming into my next question. I was going to bring in Paul, just in, Paul, seen you nodding your head a couple of times, obviously, about the benchmarking part, and we've heard of the advantages of that. I just wonder if you wanted to comment on that briefly as well, on the point that was
made. Thanks very much. I mean, we collect data across 17 local authority frontline services, but we tend to collect the allotments side of it in with our parks and grounds maintenance data at present. Perhaps that's something we need to revisit as well. You know, we look at cost, quality, productivity, customer satisfaction, etc., because you need to look at things in and around a lot of the points that Peter was making there as well. But we do that on the basis of family groups as well, so that you're comparing like with like. But of course, the reason you do benchmarking isn't just to have a league table, it's so that you have identifiable data, so that you can compare that data between each other in order that you can get in behind that data and see what some people are doing better than you, or why some people are doing worse than you, and you share that information. That's something that we are happy to revisit and expand a bit as well, because I think this is obviously an area that is really expanding. I mean, the 2015 Act has had a significant impact in Scotland for the reasons we've already heard about. A much longer term trend there as well, round about an awakening of people round about biodiversity, climate change, healthy lifestyles, social cohesion, all of those things that we hear. And there's a growing need for information and data in this area. That's something we'll be looking at again. Thanks.
Paul, thank you for that. That's really helpful. The next time I wanted to touch on was on the waiting lists, and I suppose there's a couple of things you've kind of touched on. One was around about people remaining on the waiting list for more than 5 years, because obviously there's part of the Act provision 112B talking about that and how we tackle that. And you've kind of touched on it, and just if there's anything else you want to add on it. And the second one obviously was around about communication with those on the waiting list. And Peter, you just kind of touched on it about maybe exploring with people on the waiting list about looking at new sites, for example, and what can be done to help them look at new sites. But you know, probably come to yourself again, first of all, just in terms of that about waiting lists, around about, as I said, more than 5 years, and what the communication is. You've both kind of touched on that. Don't know if there's anything else you wanted to add in that?
The waiting list, that's always been my main concern. I mean, I'll take, for example, some of the plots I've been given away recently, Inverleigh Ferry Road. Most of the people applied to join the Edinburgh waiting list in 2008, 2009. And even after all these years, you know, they're still very keen. Because what I'll do every so often, there's all kind of trickle feed, are you still interested, maybe the top 20. Just to make sure, the reason why I do that is just to make sure I know when a plot comes up, I can fill it straight away. Because you don't want plots at this time of year lying about for too long, because they're going to obviously get overgrown quite quickly. How we solve it, I don't know. I mean, some of our waiting lists in Edinburgh, some of the new sites, you know, I'll meet the 5-year deadline quite easily. But ones like, you know, the Midmars, the Inverleafs, the Ferry Roads, the Warrisons, the people are still extremely keen to get a plot after all these years. And I suppose my concern is how do you make plots available? I'm always splitting plots when they come up. But the thing is, what you can imagine is, you know, people have waited so long on their plot, they're going to put quite a bit, they're going to put an awful lot of investment into that plot. And for a lot of these people, they're going to be there a long time before they, you know, if it comes available. And of course, that's just, the way I look at it, it's a bit like a dam. You know, it's that dam is going to keep building. There's only so much I can release, you know. So the 5-year one, well, I've always been concerned about that, if I have to be honest.
Okay. Peter, I don't know if you've got anything else to add on that one at all.
No, I think as far as I'm concerned, I think that we have peaked recently, as I say, just because of what we've been through as a country in the last 2 years. However, I think in a Fife perspective, it's very much, there's quite an imbalance between sort of some sites and others, where we could have immediate availability on one, whereas the other one's got 80 odd folk or 100 folk or whatever it may be sitting on it. And I think that what I mentioned earlier about this survey, I think that will help filter people's wishes and see what they're wanting to do. As I said earlier, waiting lists for allotments is the only kind of thing that's in a lot of authorities is what's there. I think going to the future, I think that the communities have got to come forward themselves and tell us what they want, and so a lot of ways we'll be the facilitator of the bit of land, facilitator of potential maybe funding or maybe externals. There's a lot of external money out there that we can't access now, but they can. But they find that starting from zero is a bit of difficulty, and that's what I was touching on earlier. Is there a potential for having a sort of wee swash fund that the council could administer?
You must be reading my mind, because again, that's the next kind of question, and I'll kind of move on to that, because one was around about talking about community grown projects and allotment associations about getting access to funding. In terms of that, you know, and who are you aware who the big funders are, for example, and you know, what's the role of the Scottish Government in that? And I suppose the other thing as well, just on support, was around about part nine. You know, what, if there was any thoughts you had on the support from Scottish Government in part in terms of part nine of the legislation. So again, it's talking about the funding, what support is there from funders, and also, you know, is there anything else the Scottish Government could do in terms of just that broader support?
That has always been my question for day one. It's okay bringing this in, but who's got the money to pay for it? And even though you could look at cocktails of funding, the difficult thing for a group to do is to get the initial funds, and then they could start match funding thereafter. And as I said, excuse the pun, but a seed corn grant, if you called it that, wouldn't be a bad thing. And that's something that I feel that the Scottish Government could bring to the table to, and it's something that the local authority then has control over, and considering the Act applies to land owned or leased by the local authority, it's not as though it's the money is going outside onto privately owned land. And that would certainly allow a different approach to be taken, but, and allow the groups to take forward at their speed. Because that's my entire view with it now, is, you know, the days of when the local authorities imposed things upon the communities, i.e. play parks or allotment sites or whatever, they've gone. And so, and thanks to the Community Empowerment Act, it quite clearly states where we need to be. And that's changed, the mindset's taken these last 7 years for to sort of start turning. Not just on section part nine, but on the other bits, because it all links together, and I think that's something we spoke about earlier, is there's a link right across the board, whether it be cat transfers or whatever it may be. So I think my biggest hurdle is the two things is the waiting list thresholds, and the second thing is the funding side of it.
Ian, anything to add on that? I know we've kind of both touched on that, but
I think Peter's probably summed it up very, very, very well indeed. It is, you know, funding's the big issue. And of course, the land, well, for us here in Edinburgh, is a big issue. Even though we are looking at various pockets of land we could potentially develop into allotments, we still need the funding for that. And the way things are going these days is, you know, I mean, certainly from internal budgets of the various councils, it's a kind of fight for, well, we need 100,000 for new allotments, or maybe that new school is needing done, and that's going to take precedent over the potential for a new allotment site.
That's me, unless anybody else wants
to. Okay, yeah, so Paul just wanted to come in on this, and then I'm a bit mindful of time, so we're going to move on. Thanks.
Thanks, Convener. I'll keep it brief then. It was just to say an experience in England that a similar government here came forward with pocket parks initiatives, one-off funding for the development of pockets of land for parks purposes. One of the big issues with that, as Peter has highlighted there, is ongoing cost, revenue cost as well. It's okay given that one-off capital cost to develop a bit of land. But there can be the ongoing maintenance costs that you then need to find as well. So it's important that any initiatives like that that did come forward with one-off funding, you know, is thought through that there will be a maintenance element of that as well on an ongoing basis.
Thanks very much for that. So we're going to move on to touch a little bit on local food growing strategies. And I think I'm going to probably put these questions mainly to Ian and Peter. So I'm just curious to know to what extent you've been involved in the development of local food strategies, both in Edinburgh and Fife, and to, I'll leave it at that. Yeah, Ian.
Some of my colleagues in the various strategy groups, they're more involved in the food growing strategy than myself. Fiona McLeod is mostly doing that just now, so I haven't got a lot of experience in that at the moment.
So allotments haven't been brought into the mix?
Not at the moment. We Edinburgh's its allotment strategy is 2017 to 2027,
right.
And then we have a food growing strategy, and that's been prepared by one of my other colleagues.
Right. Okay.
I think it's almost complete, I believe.
Great. Okay. And Peter, have you been involved in any, to an extent?
Yes. We've got our allotment strategy, but we're involved in food growing strategy headed up by Ross Spalding and his team, who's quite climate change, environment sort of thing. So within that side of things, the food growing strategy, yes, allotments play part of it. However, they've created six pillars. We're one of them. Then we've got food poverty, you know, all the different things. Equally, the people that are around the table are major providers in Fife, like so kettle produce and so forth. So they're looking at what the surplus food from there is. So, however, there seems to be quite a bit of confusion between, and it's the way it's written in the Act, is about an allotment strategy and the food growing strategy. My mind is allotments is per se, as per part 9. However, the food growing strategy encompasses everything else within that local authority's area, that whether it be surplus produce from the supermarkets to whatever else it may be. And that's, there is an area of confusion there, because if I haven't spoken to other colleagues in other local authorities, there's a wee bit of, well, we've done our food strategy, but I'm saying, well, what about your allotment strategy? So there's a wee bit of misunderstanding that maybe needs to be clarified at a higher level for that. But our food growing strategy is due to be completed by August. It will have an influence on the new allotment strategy because of the different diverse approach, because we've brought other people to the table. What it has done is it's brought more people to the table than the allotment strategy ever did. It's brought NHS Fife into the table, it's brought estates into the table, it's brought private landowners into the table, who are looking at diversifying parts of their farming to different sort of usage. So there's all different permutations, but I think from the food growing strategy side of it, the allotment strategy is very focused, but the food growing strategy to me is a wee bit like a spider. There's that many legs on it, and it's going to be very difficult to make sure that's coordinated and aligned, more importantly, with the allotment strategy. Because I keep on saying, well, it's all very nice to have your food growing strategy, but we have got a statutory obligation under part 9 to do this. So we're currently under that food growing strategy, mapping all the allotment sites, orchards, and so forth for the whole of Fife. It started in the west of Fife as first phase. And working through with Greener Kirkcaldy and what they're doing. So very much gathering that information and bringing it to the table. Again, it's who's going to coordinate it in the end of the day, and who's going to make sure that the dots are joined up for delivery, because sometimes I feel that these documents could be quite lost and they basically go on the shelf and no seen for another 5 years or something.
Much for that. Paul, I didn't direct the question to you, but I just actually realized that maybe with your overview hat, do you have an understanding of how the food strategies are being developed across Scotland?
Just really, as you say, from a strategic level, there's that many different strategies that local authorities are working at present and trying to integrate that I think it's still at that stage where people are trying to put things together with climate change strategies, action plans, etc. You know, it's an ongoing process. It's not really ingrained in the way we would like it to be yet.
Yeah, I think that's something that I'm beginning to realise in my role in this committee, that there are so many strategies that local authorities are having to look at. Strategies, plans. Many different things. But I mean, I guess one of the things there is that integration that you're talking about, where local food growing strategy can actually speak to the local authority's climate strategy and the biodiversity strategy. So it is that kind of that holistic thinking. I'm going to bring in Marie McNair with our kind of closing themes around community organisations, volunteering and planning themes.
Thank you, Convener. Just as kind of what has been clear really from the written submissions and the committee visits we've done is the importance of volunteering to successful community growing. How can local authorities continue to help community growing and allotments to thrive in areas with kind of lower levels of volunteering?
That to me. Ian, you could go first on that one.
Oh, that's a good question. I suppose giving them the land to start off with, I suppose, would be the important one here. You say the community asset transfer would be a starting point, but as I say, I don't have a lot of experience with that.
I think from my point of view is that groups can become very disheartened with the red tape part of it and the expectations mm-hmm. of just getting left to get on with it. And as was mentioned there, there's very much needs an umbilical cord from the local authority to the groups to continue the support. And equally that needs to come from the Scottish Government down the way. And my view is that if I've taken forward a growing project, I'll go and I'll meet with a group and I'll listen to what they've got to say and listen for their ambitions and analyse that, bring that together and ask them to sort of take a step behind me as an officer so that when the flak happens, i.e. when the planning application goes in and there's all the nimbyism attached to that, because there is, and there's no sense in saying there's not, and what happens is then is I'll guide them through that process. Once we get the red tape bit out of the way, and it comes to then back to them, give them, let them take the step forward and walk beside them for a wee while, and eventually you should be able to take a step back. And that's kind of, to me, is empowering them without, because I've seen too many groups go in there and they absolutely get a stoning to start with, and they say, right, we're not doing this any longer and we've had enough. And sometimes I have seen it where the main objectors actually become part of the project once the project's on the ground. So because of actually a lack of understanding what that project's going to deliver. Tayport and Fife's a good example of that with their community garden. And I think I was hunted out of Tayport for months but the thing was that the important bit for me was that the groups or the members of the group didn't get headhunted and headed off at the pass by the negativism within the site because they couldn't see past their own nose sort of thing. To me, there are a lot of ambitions out there. We've got the hard job, and Sandy included, that's in the back of me here, is about harnessing these ambitions and harnessing the expectations that are placed upon us. And not in a bad way, it's about guiding them and also, there could be some third sector organisations out there, as I say, that have got expectations beyond belief, but you have to go then back. And the important bit for me is to make sure that if there's groups, are they representational of actually the bigger, wider community? And so we're not upsetting the whole thing.
I think that's a good point. I think what you're conveying is the importance of that support and all of that. And I believe Paul wants to come in, and then just mindful of time. So I think Marie's got a couple more questions. If we can keep those responses succinct, Paul.
Facilitation, nurture, subsidy support on an ongoing but diminishing basis. That's brief.
Brilliant, thank you very much. Marie?
Yeah, that's what I picked up in Glasgow visits yesterday. Obviously, they're just wanting a wee hand up from the council, the requests that they're kind of on deaf ears and stuff like that. So if they could get a wee hand up, that'd be really important to them because they're just wanting to go on and grow, The next question is obviously, how can communities use local place plans to ensure local authorities include community growing in local authority development plans? I don't know if any of you could answer that one.
We have ongoing discussions with planning all the time. It's written into the guidance in Fife for the planning officers. Admittedly, there's a good correspondence goes on there. Equally, we've got CLD workers out there who are working with the communities. So there's this place approach And so very, what we intend to do is, Fife, as you probably know, is split into seven areas. So we've got a lead CLD officer in each of that seven areas. And they will be getting some training on green space very shortly, so that they are not giving the public out there false hopes, in a sense, you know, about delivery and about, you know, it's not just all sort of just let's get the spade in the ground, because we've got contamination or whatever it may be. So it's just a wee bit of knowledge for them to understand. So that, and again, it helps me because there's seven of them and only one of me, so it helps coordinate it a wee bit.
Thanks for that. Anybody else? Please move on.
Sandy.
Oh, Sandy there, yeah? Yeah. Okay, the last one, obviously, could the planning system be better used to ensure adequate provision is made for new and existing community growers? So maybe Sandy's nodding at the in the public gallery. I don't know if he wants to join the table and answer that one.
I think we've all agreed, Sandy.
We've got another panel and we'll organise that. Okay. Yep, thanks. We can just keep focused with where we're at. Thank you.
I would agree that yes, there needs to be, so through the planning guidance, there needs to be relaxations so that the under-permitted development, we could probably develop community gardens and allotment sites. However, obviously there would be restrictions placed upon if it was obviously within a designed landscape, for example, or it was a conservation area or something like that. And also maybe some guidance on structures. So if we were involved in polytunnels and things that, you know, there might be, it could be probably much, much easier than it is. And what I've found is from personal experiences, it depends on A, what mood the planning officer is in that day, And the second one is there's no continuity across the planning staff. So it depends who you get. So one wants a container painted green and the other one wants it clad with timber. So I had a meeting last week with head of planning to say I think we actually need to get some sort of guidance for your staff, so that I suggested he maybe had a dedicated officer. However, he told me he doesn't have the resources for that. So what I said was, well, could we write some guidance for all your officers for to go by? Because it's quite difficult. And one of the things just before I've touched on that before we finish is Scottish Water have came back to our last two applications and said they're refusing to connect on a water supply onto a grown site. Now, we've had all this hassle before about double check valves and non-return valves and everything, but to me, that's a fundamental thing that if, you know, if we've got a major supplier like that saying, well, you can't have water, but we need the water. You know, that's the problem. So that's going to be restrictive as well. So it's something we're moving to note.
Red tape. Thanks, Vinnie. That's me.
Okay. Thank you very much. Nobody else wants to come in on the planning bit. Paul, do you have any comments about planning?
Yeah, just one thought about it, really. I know that other administrations are experimenting with the concept of biodiversity net gain, and perhaps that's something that we could look to in terms of the Scottish planning frameworks.
Okay, thanks for that insight. I think I've just made a note here also, maybe we need to look at Scottish Water. That came up quite early on, and you have to pay commercial charges for Scottish Water. So maybe there needs to be some kind of conversation there that could ease the way for more allotment and community growing spaces. It seems strange to me that you're having to respond to commercial charge. But okay, so thanks very much for all the witnesses on the first panel. It was a really very insightful, helpful conversation. And I think actually it was good to hear more of your anecdotes. And it certainly painted the bigger picture for me of what you're, you know, dealing with. And just even things like, Peter, you were talking about understanding the context of a company's going out of business in Fife, and then therefore you might be looking at having more people applying for allotments. So very useful conversation. So now there's going to be a short break before we begin our second panel of witnesses. I now welcome our second panel of witnesses to the meeting, who are joining us both remotely and in person. And we have Sandy Patterson, Assistant Manager from Food Growing, Glasgow City Council. Amy Alcorn, who's from Green Space Programme in the Scottish Borders Council. Marina Curran-Colhart, who's the Local Biodiversity Officer for Argyll and Bute Council. And Sinclair Lang, who is the Policy and Strategy Manager from Aberdeen City Council. And it'd be helpful, once again, if members could direct their questions to a specific witness where possible, although I will be happy to bring others in who wish to contribute. And I'd be grateful for our witnesses who are online to type an R in the chat function in BlueJeans to indicate if you do want to come in. And I'll now open up the session to members, and I'll start with the first question. So let me see. So the question is basically, we've been learning in last week's session, in our visits, and also this morning's session, that clearly there's huge benefits for community growing spaces, for people to be growing, both in community growing spaces and allotments. And I'd be interested to hear, and maybe I'll start this question with, I'll direct this to Marina to start. I'd be interested to hear what you think the main barriers are preventing local authorities from creating more allotments and community growing spaces.
Thank you for your question and good morning, convener. In terms of barriers, I'll have to give you a little bit of a potted history in terms of Argyll and Bute. We only have three allotments and they're run by allotment associations. The land is council owned and the allotment association pay a peppercorn rent on an annual basis. In terms of the barriers, I think people's expectations, certainly one of them in terms of the land searches we do, and we work with the states on this in terms of looking at growing opportunities within towns and villages in order to meet the needs of the applicants on the waiting list in a particular area. But we also acknowledge that there is an educational role in what reasonable steps are that the council have to take under Part 9 of the Act. Also, I think in terms of community benefit and community empowerment, I think individuals sometimes can have a misunderstanding of the expectation of what we can deliver, but also what we can what we can provide. We have had a particular group that have been knocking on the door for a number of years for land, and we've provided a number of sites, but their expectations were basically that they were fully facilitated in terms of boundary fencing, water and other facilities. So, you know, expectations need to be managed, and I think that's one of the barriers that we've tried to overcome with information and signposting in terms of meeting those needs.
Thanks very much, Marina. Sinclair, what's your experience in Aberdeen?
Thank you for the opportunity to come and give evidence today as well. I think it's been a really interesting conversation. I think a lot of it's come out this morning. The benefits are, as we know, multiple, and they're outlined in the guidance that was issued in 2018. I myself was involved in a social return on investment research study in Aberdeen in 2012, looking at the benefits of allotments. And something I just wanted to pick up from the conversation this morning was that for every pound invested, there was £8 of return in investment for community growing sites. So there is clearly a massive benefit there, but there are barriers undoubtedly. For us, the discussion about finance has already been had, both in terms of revenue and capital. So for Aberdeen City Council, we spend more on allotments than we make on allotments. So there is a deficit there in our revenue budget. How we manage that going forward, I guess, is a decision for politicians and what to do about the pricing of allotments, but it does have an impact. And when we look at that across all the other things that our ground services and others need to do, biodiversity, for climate change, land management, engaging communities and so on, it becomes a multiple complex problem. So maintenance is a constant word that's raised whenever we talk about what we're going to do with our land, how we're going to engage communities in the use of our land. And then there's the question of capital. Obviously, there isn't a lot of money swirling around for public authorities and it's diminishing. How we can use that as well. We can access money from outside, but a lot of that, again, is being directed towards climate change investment, rightly so, and biodiversity and not necessarily food growing opportunities. There's capital and revenue finance issues that we face. On the other side, we've got a limited number of people that can actually work in this area. Again, that's a revenue budget issue, but as our waiting lists increase, there's a need to manage that process, which then takes away from actually delivering further allotment sites and supporting communities in delivering those sites. So that resource base is getting thinner as demand is increasing. I think we have one dedicated officer in Aberdeen who works on allotments, so that's a relatively new thing. Communities, there's been a lot of conversation about engaging communities, community asset transfer process and so on. It's complicated. We need to provide that umbilical cord, I think the term was used, for communities that requires resource from our assets teams, from our community learning and development teams. And they also need to provide that resource around lots of other community issues, not just food growing. There's a complicated process that probably puts communities off in terms of delivering more sites for themselves, fear, continuity, etc. So there's a lot of resource that goes into bringing communities forward and supporting them. And it's not always there to really handhold them all the way through that process. Planning is another thing that's been mentioned, and I think planning can do more. It's getting better, and I think the new local development plans will take a stronger role in terms of protecting and delivering more sites. Certainly in Aberdeen, we're building it into policy. We've built it into developer obligations, negotiations, and we need to put more pressure, I think, on developers to deliver sites through master planning and through site delivery. But I think the new local development plans will help with that process. It's just there will be a lag in actually seeing delivery on the ground in terms of that. So it's money, it's resources in terms of council, it's communities, developers, planners, etc. It's a multiple complex problem.
Thank you very much for that very thorough overview. I just wanted to see if Amy or Sandy want to come in on barriers. Sandy, yep.
Yep, thanks, Chair. Yeah, there's several barriers that we think, we believe, are preventing additional provision from happening. Firstly, it is a perceived capacity issue within areas of socio-economic disadvantage. There is also a perceived distrust of the local authorities by community groups and citizens, particularly in areas of socio-economic disadvantage. We seek to work in a collaborative approach, and often there is a capacity building issue to be looked at and a plan developed for that before we can move to the stage of actually constructing sites. Our most recent site in Grochapel, which was brought to our attention by Police Scotland, who ended up as an excellent partner in it, took us a period of 30 months from inception to actually breaking a spade into the ground for growers. The narrative around about that has been touched on several times this morning about managing expectations. There is an enthusiastic spike at the start, and then if the expectations aren't met very, very quickly, indeed that enthusiasm wanes. Resilience and gumption are two character traits specific to the Scottish personality, and encouraging that and making people aware and having a transparent conversation with them in the first instance can often go a long way to keeping these people on the journey with you. There's also the competing priorities for the use of available open space, particularly in areas of urban density. And in post-industrial cities such as Glasgow, land contamination is a big issue as well. So that's other factors that actually come into the mix, which may not be recognised by many of our citizens. Food growing essentially is not normalised within everyday life, and I think that's possibly one of the biggest barriers that we have. People have disconnected with their food, where it comes from and how they actually produce it. There's a limited awareness within the educational curriculum about the benefits of food growing as well. The density of the urban housing and the competing priorities and available space is a huge one. People see spaces, however, there is many priorities that a city needs to address, and the food growing, while raising up the political agenda at this point in time, doesn't always maintain itself in that level. So the statutory obligation provided by the Community Empowerment Act Part 9 have been excellent. the community asset transfer side of it is probably convoluted a lot more than it needed to be convoluted. It's a barrier to many, many community groups from accessing land. And in Glasgow, we've taken a quite unique step in developing an organisation called People Make Glasgow Communities, which is a step below the community asset transfer, but still provides the tenure that groups need to access funding from groups such as the National Lottery. And it's pleasing to say that we've recently transferred over an old production nursery to Locavore, an organisation many of you may know, on a 25-year tenure. And we look forward to seeing that site coming to fruition over the next 3 years. Havenford Growing recognised as an individual theme within the placemaking standard would also be a benefit and remove many of the barriers that I would understand. It puts food growing on the same level as many of the other themes within the placemaking standard, and we always try to take a placemaking standard approach to the development and delivery of our allotment and growing spaces within Glasgow. And the need for a clear toolkit to measure and highlight the additional benefits of food growing, local growing and health benefits, social interaction, green prescriptions, community cohesion, all these other qualitative benefits that don't show up in the spreadsheet. Something really needs to be done on that, and it's something that we've been working towards initially in our pilot over at the Grow Chapel. We're trying to work with focus groups and carry out a 5-year research programme to actually prove the case that the benefits that allotments make.
Thanks very much for that response, and that's a really interesting point around food growing needing to be in a placemaking standard. That could be a great help. Amy, you wanted to come in.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you very much for having me today. After listening to what Sandy's just said, I couldn't agree more with absolutely every one of his points. He has said many of the things that I wanted to bring into this conversation. I completely agree that none of this can be sat on a spreadsheet. It is really about enhancing people's lives with food growing and getting it into the curriculum and getting young people involved from a very early age so that they have experience of this and so it is something that they take forward for the rest of their lives. I'm probably quite different from most of the other witnesses that you've had today. I have been working in public sector for 7 months entirely. Previous to this, I have worked in third sector and managed a food growing charity that worked doing food growing projects across the Scottish borders. So I'm very new to local authority work, but the reason that I applied for the job here at the council, being the Green Space Officer, was because I feel so passionately about community food growing and that everybody should be able to have access to it. And during my role, I have worked with at least 20 community groups who want to get growing food. And that's where I see a huge demand now, is that because of the strategy and because Scottish Borders Council have managed to get their strategy out and shown it to people across the borders, that so many people are coming forward. And sometimes these people are individual people who are coming forward to ask for advice and help. And other times they're schools, they're primary schools, they're secondary schools. They are organisations that have a wealth of experience delivering community growing projects, but they want extra help. They want, for example, recently, they want compost. So I manage a network for the Scottish Borders Council, which is the Scottish Borders Community Food Growers Network. And during this, we have managed to provide sort of 50 tonnes of compost to growing spaces. I guess what I'm trying to say is there are barriers, absolutely. And for me, they seem to come down to financial barriers. But there is a huge drive, I think, across Scotland and definitely in the borders, that people are desperate to grow and they are desperate for help with growing. And that is something that I find really encouraging and welcoming to see. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Amy, for your contribution. And I think that Borders Council are obviously very lucky to have somebody who's been working in the food growing in the communities and third sector area coming, you know, into the local authority. And I'm sure you've got a lot to offer in terms of that perspective. I'm going to now bring in Miles Briggs with another theme and his questions.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to our second panel. Thanks for joining us here and online today. I wanted to ask a question with regards to Part 9 of the Act, and specifically to ask what difference you feel that's managed to make in terms of access to new allotments, but also For those who are maybe not looking for an allotment but access to community growing, where you've seen that expanded. So I'll maybe start with Sinclair, and if anyone else wants to come in, please do.
Thank you for the question. I was going to put an R in and say, actually, can I come in on that one? So I think part 9 of the Act has really helped, actually. Well, if you look at the numbers on the spreadsheet, you know, our waiting lists have gone through the roof, partly, I guess, because the Community Empowerment Act came in and there was a lot of promotion, a lot of engagement around this issue. That brought people out of the woodwork, made them aware that the opportunities were available. So that pushed things up. On top of that, we've got COVID and people's desire to get outdoors, impacts on people's budgets as well more recently, and the availability to grow your own food and so on. So there's been a number of reasons, a perfect storm to send waiting lists through the roof. So it looks bad, but actually I think there's been a lot of opportunity because it's really forced local authorities to think again about how they're going to approach this issue. If there wasn't a duty on local authorities to act, we'd probably just sit on the waiting list for a period of time because of all those barriers and all those challenges that I mentioned before, specifically probably finance. But it really has forced us to get round the table with our partners and to look at what we can do to provide more access to allotments and community food growing spaces. So we pulled together a partnership in Aberdeen where we developed the food growing strategy together. And that really allowed us to look at the issue from a whole range of angles and put a lot of effort into not just allotments, but actually access to food and the whole food system. Specifically, we worked with Green Space Scotland, who were great and helped us with our framework. But we also worked with an organisation called CFINE, Community Food Initiatives Northeast, who look at the whole food system and provide food skills, food banks, support for community growing groups, access to land and so on. So the emphasis for us initially was really around how do we get communities more engaged with food all the way through the process, and how do we give them access to the land, whether that's one person going to a community site, a group setting up a community site, or any other range of activities across that spectrum. So it's really, really helped in bringing that together. Aberdeen is also part of the National Movement of Sustainable Food Places partnerships. So we have a bronze award at the moment. We put in for our silver award. That partnership as well helps to look at the whole food system and who can get involved where. So there has been a huge movement outside of traditional allotments, you know, that space where one individual or a family goes to grow their foods provided by the local authority, and a much bigger move, which has seen community groups pop up, do community asset transfers, or just take on a bit of land for a little while and get involved. There's been a massive increase in that, and that includes volunteering and all the other benefits. But back to the allotments waiting list, we're now forced through Part 9 of the Act to actually look and take reasonable measures as to what we're going to do to tackle that waiting list. We have recruited a full-time allotments officer who's now managing those waiting lists much stronger than they were in the past. So I think pointing to a question earlier, you know, we look at our waiting list twice annually and do a cleanse, if you like, where we contact those on the waiting list to see whether they still really want to be on there. We do audits of our sites 3 times a year to make sure that those sites are being used and that people have fair access to the allotments that are there. So that's got a lot stronger. We've got a dedicated resource who's working hard to make sure those sites are well managed and accessible. We're also doing the other thing of splitting plots, having micro plots, starter plots and so on that we've talked about before. And I think that's really, really helped in providing sites or plots that are more usable to individuals. Not everyone wants those big tennis court sized plots. They just want somewhere to grow a few fruit and vegetables. So the micro plots, the startup plots, the better managing of the sites, the dedicated resource to managing allotments. And I think there is a lag period. So Aberdeen has over 1,000 people on our waiting list at the moment. 5 years ago, we had 150. So it's been a massive change. But I think once that COVID and the awareness is we get the drop off, we've probably plateaued, we're going to get a bit of a drop off, sites are being managed better, and once we can start bringing forward more allotment sites through the resources that we have, I think we will see that waiting list drop, and that probably wouldn't happen if it wasn't for this duty upon local authorities.
Thank you for that. Marina, I think you wanted to come in on this as well.
Great, thank you, Minister. I've just come in on new developments. Certainly there's opportunities for community growing facilities within open space protection areas, and we allow that under our our sustainable guidance in our LDP. Also factoring in nature in crisis as well from a biodiversity point of view, you know, the benefits are right across the board in terms of not only food, but all the associated benefits in terms of biodiversity, in particular pollinators, etc., and obviously climate change. But it's essentially about placemaking. And certainly what underpins it for me is the community empowerment. And certainly in Argyll, we're very much community-based. Small groups of people have a common interest, but we also have other factors that help with that in terms of local development trusts, which can help small groups develop their project, and particularly food growing, to just going through the hassle of the planning side of things, the community engagement, and building on that project, and then having that ownership as well. I think that is really important. And listening to Peter earlier and Ian, and the wealth of management effort they have to put in terms of council-owned allotments, it's something that's quite foreign to us in Argyll and Bute, because communities have been actually getting up and doing it for themselves for quite a long time. But with these tools of development trusts in the background, helping them sort out funding. But the council has been there in terms of helping enable, and there's been mention of asset transfer, which we're particularly keen on, but it does come with a lot of caveats, and that's something that, you know, we're trying to make it easy for community groups in order to succeed with their projects. Also, in terms of farm diversification, there's quite a lot of interest with small and crofting communities to open up growing spaces. Very traditional view, and I'm sure we can all picture in our minds what an allotment looks like. And in terms of the people that manage them, that has changed. And I think perhaps it needs a sort of an updating in terms of its image, to be more engaging with a lot more people and also a lot more age groups as well. But farm diversification is one certainly that can take the hassle out of a community and individuals being able to grow their own on the size of plot that they choose to manage. Also within the school side of things, we have eco schools, but also there's food growing programs. And one school I visited there recently in Loch Gilphead, they had some polytunnels, and they were supplying the kitchen with some fruit and vegetables and herbs, and even making jam from some of the fruits of their labour as well. So there is this culture of food growing and certainly nutrition in the schools. It's just making sure that it jumps the gap to taking it home, and not just sort of saying that's, you know, siloed in the school environment. That is actually for life. And I think that needs to come out. And just finishing on my point there, in terms of health and wellbeing, certainly we have a project with the Coast and Countryside Trust in Argyll called Branching Out. And it's for people that have suffered mental illness. It gets them out. We initially started with woodlands. Now we're into growing plots. And certainly the benefits for those people, our clients, are immeasurable in the sense of their health and well-being, being out in the fresh air, even cooking outside, and seeing I suppose tasting their produce as well, which is so important. And I think the taste of homegrown can never be, you know, compete. The supermarkets and other outlets can't compete with that. So I think, you know, there's certainly a lot more we can do in terms of encouraging. But in Argyll, we're not at a standing start by any matter of means. But our culture is very, very different from the council having allotments. We don't have an allotment officer, but we do maintain a waiting list. And for our sins, we've 106 people waiting for allotment spaces. And we're working with local allotment associations, but also community gardens as well. And I think that's one perhaps area that could be explored in terms of engaging people with growing their own, they see what's happening with the community garden. They get have a little bit of an interest. They might help out somebody with watering if they're away on holiday, and suddenly they're bitten by the bug. And I think perhaps a little bit of osmosis on that level goes a long way. Thank you.
That's great. Thank you, Marina. Amy, did you want to come in then? If Sandy, you want to come as well?
Yes, please. I wanted to touch on the idea of part nine and how that has helped. And I'd say it really has helped having this legislation, because it's meant that we have really had to look at our waiting lists and how we can manage those. And we found that we have six sites across the Scottish borders. And when we really did study them and look at them really thoroughly, we found that there were people on every single waiting list across all five. So we have managed to do a cleanse of the waiting list, and we do email everybody annually and ask if they do still want to be on the waiting list for their designated area. The other thing, the other thing that we do is to send them details of an interactive map that we have built for our website that shows every community garden across the Scottish borders, as well as the allotment association managed sites, which are separate from our own sites. There are five across the borders that are on Scottish Borders Council land, but they're not managed by Scottish Borders Council, whereas we have six that we do manage ourselves. So we give all this information out, as well as links to the local community gardens, so that people have got the option to choose whether they want to remain on the list or whether maybe looking for a different alternative is there. But what we have found is that most people want to stay on the list. Some people will go to a community garden and they do want that community, they want that connection with their community, but the need for allotments is definitely still there. People want their own space that isn't part of a community garden that they can go to and just be by themselves and do their own thing and do their own gardening or their own growing. There is a massive space for community gardens as well. And this was touched on in the first session, that there are some people that take on allotments but don't have the horticultural experience. And community gardens are a brilliant place to introduce people who are interested in growing into a horticultural environment. But once they've been at a community garden for a few years, they may well then decide that there is the right time to apply for an allotment. So I think these community gardens and allotments can work in harmony together, but I think there is absolutely a need for more allotments. I mean, our waiting list is currently equal to the amount of plots that we have, so we are definitely over the 50% threshold. During the 7 months I've been here, we have managed to create seven new plots, which are at the very final point of having their fences built now that they've been cleared, and they'll be offered out very soon. But there is still so much work to be done on finding the sites and finding the resources to be able to put these into place. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks. Sandy, did you have anything to say?
Yeah, the Community Empowerment Act, I suppose the biggest impact we noticed straight away was the opportunity for collaboration. Previously, there was almost a them and us. We understand that it'll be very challenging to deliver our statutory obligations under the Community Empowerment Act as a standalone local authority. The strength of our networks come into that there, and I would commend Glasgow Community Food Network and all its partners and the approach and the openness that they've taken with Glasgow City Council. It's been refreshing because it helped us to identify key actions arising from an extensive engagement process that we carried out with our citizens of the city. And with local growers at the forefront of that. And so that developed how we shaped our approach. That provided an appropriate policy position as well for food growing. Particularly part 9 of the Act, it's given consideration across many departments within the local authority. We now have an internal officers working group taking in officers from many departments within Glasgow City Council. We have an external stakeholders group as well that meets quarterly. That's developing the Let's Grow Together fund at the moment that will encourage citizens and organisations within the city to tap into this funding stream to develop sites. has created a web page. It provides almost a one-stop shop within Glasgow with digital mapping arising from the engagement process of the land that was put forward by our citizens that is currently being assessed for suitability for growing. And we encourage our citizens to, and our organisations within the city to come forward and challenge us to move forward with those sites and take them forward. It's also opened up the discussion as well beyond allotments to the point that we perceive food growing to be a mosaic of a variety of streams and themes, from community gardens all the way through window boxes to urban farms. Is there any reason we can't be growing in church grounds? Is there any reason we can't be growing in school grounds? Could universities and other landowners within the city contribute more as well? It's certainly opened up the conversation with our housing associations in Glasgow as well, and we've got a specific group looking at supporting local housing associations to develop growing spaces as well. And it's raised an awareness at grassroots and at political levels of the contributions that food growing can provide to achieving the strategies and policies of local authority. So that's where it's positioned us at this point in time.
That's great, thank you. And I think you made a really important point there with regards to making this about every public sector organisation looking at their land and potentially what they can hand over, and especially if it's already fenced, you know, some of the setup costs. I think all my questions have been covered. I'm so happy to hand back.
Thanks, Miles. Now move over to questions from Marie McNair.
Thanks, convener, and good morning, panel. Just a kind of one question that's been covered with some people, but to what extent are local authorities taking a more joined up approach to the provision of growing spaces, recognising the contribution that allotments and community growing spaces can make to meeting that demand? I know that, Sandy, you've kind of touched on that. I'm just going to direct my question to Amy, if that's okay.
Yes, sorry, Ed. Absolutely. So one of the things that I think you were asking about was whether or not we can sort of touch on working with our community planning partners and work with them more to use the spaces that they have for community growing. This was something that we addressed a few months ago, where we presented to the Community Planning Partnership and then up to the Strategic Board to ask them to put this into their plans so that they could put it into their plans moving forward, that they would look at their green spaces and start promoting people to be able to go in and access and use it. And this has worked with some areas in the NHS that we've been working with in Huntlyburn in the Scottish Borders, and also with housing association land. The housing associations that we're working with in the Scottish Borders are really on board now to use their land, and there's a community garden that's just started working in partnership with Abundant Borders in Selkirk that's also got a partnership with the high school. So it's brilliant to facilitate these groups working together and coming up with green space opportunities for local residents that wouldn't necessarily be there without the joined up approach of all of the organisations who are on board. Does that answer the question, or would you like me?
No, that's fine. Convener, other question has been covered, so that's me on that one.
Thanks very much, Marie. Now moving over to questions from Paul McClellan.
Thank you, convener, and thank you, panel. Kind of touched on this one as well. It's talking around about the waiting lists, and I think it's really just asking one around about, you know, I think you kind of touched on how many people are on the waiting lists in your own area. Would there be a benefit in tracking that nationally? And there's a couple of other things we're asking around about the waiting list. Under provision 112 talks around about being more than 5 years, people taken off if they've been on the list for 5 years. And what kind of help is there for people on the waiting list looking at other alternatives that are out there? So I know there's a few questions, but it's really just talking about how you manage your waiting list. Sandy, I'll probably come to yourself first of all and then open it up after that.
Thank you very much. Management of waiting lists is currently devolved within Glasgow. It is something that we're working on, and as we embark on our discussion with our allotment associations around rules and regulations, that will certainly be one of the points that we discuss. We'll be looking at a centralised waiting list, and again, I'd refer back to the Community Empowerment Act, and in fact, it's given us a statutory provision. It allows us then to look at IT solutions on this. And we've been working with software companies in the south of England who are looking to develop a package to assist with the management of our waiting lists. It will be linked to our GIS system, and that will allow people to identify plots that are available currently and can apply for that. We manage them in a chronological order, first come, first served. So many of our people have been on waiting lists. Anecdotally, I'm advised up to 12 years in Glasgow, but I'm also very aware that other allotment sites, you may only have to wait 2 weeks in Glasgow. So it's an interesting blend that we have, and it'll be interesting to see how, when we move to the centralised list, that pans out. Those that tend to be on the waiting list for the longer times that I've mentioned there tend to be site-specific. They want a plot in one site and one site only. And we welcome that as well. I mean, it's within the place standard, within livable neighbourhoods. However, we like to provide as much scope and options as possible, so we will be looking at a city-wide approach to that. How we can accelerate providing, well, to manage a waiting list and get them down would be accelerating provision. That's difficult in itself, and it's not without its challenges. Our networking approach and our collaboration approach allows other organisations to seek and apply for funding that isn't available to the local authorities, and we can support them on that and facilitate and signpost. We've also been kind of in conversation with Glasgow Allotment Forum, who had recognised that people on waiting lists were perhaps just there in a limbo state. And they've tried to activate that by developing an organisation called the People's Plot. And the People's Plot then pull together like-minded folks within the waiting list to try and advocate for development sites. And we are helpful and supportive with that as well.
Okay, Sandy, thanks for that. I don't know who else wants to come in now.
Sinclair wants to come in.
Thank you. So our waiting lists are a local authority only waiting lists that we manage. There are private sites in Aberdeen, which I think we have 135. So we have about 550 council plots and about 135 private plots. It's just the council waiting list that we manage. We also do that through a digital process now, which obviously makes it easier for people to apply and for us to communicate with them. And like was just said, we also do that in a chronological way. I don't think we've had anyone over 5 years on our waiting list. There may be one or two, but those are looking for particular sites, so they're willing to wait that little bit longer to make sure they get somewhere closer to home or that has the facilities that they're looking for. In terms of national tracking, yes, absolutely. Having a national picture is always useful on any subject. And I would imagine that using the annual allotments reports would be a useful way to do that. If it has standardised information that can then be aggregated at a national level. Certainly hearing the conversations today has been really useful to understand what the contexts are in other local authorities. And it's quite varied by the sounds of it. And when you can look at that data, you can also drill down into it and know who's a contact around particular issues. If an authority is doing very well, what insights can they share that we can learn from, that we can then build into our approach more locally? So very much yes to a national tracking approach. Questions also asked around alternatives. So we now have, we also have a digital map of our allotment sites, our community growing spaces, our community growing projects, and so on across the city. So we use Google for that, and we just simply map out everything that's going on, and we provide that online to allotment applicants when they come in. And it means that they become aware that there are other things available to them rather than just allotments, where they'll have to wait for a number of potentially a number of years to get access to a site. So either as an alternative or as something to keep them going in the meantime, where can they get involved with either just getting access to a community site, developing a community site themselves, or other sorts of projects that are going on. And we have provided projects for schools and funding for schools to develop growing within their sites. We've also encouraged workplaces to take up growing as well. So we've had almost a three-pronged approach for our local outcome improvement plan to say schools growing together, communities growing together, and workplaces growing together. So we're really trying to encourage people to get access to food growing through any route available to them. And we have developed new sites and so on as well, both community sites and council allotment sites too. So there is a huge range of opportunities available to people. It's making them aware of them and facilitating their access to them, including things like partnership working and funding, encouraging NHS, our sports facilities, etc., to try and make their land available for these sorts of opportunities as well.
Thanks for that. That kind of takes me on to the next part.
Come in.
Yep, sorry. I think Mary wants to come in as well.
Marina.
Mary, I'm sorry.
Yes, and just in terms of managing our waiting list in Argyll and Bute, we've kind of set up a dating agency, really. We have the map and interim opportunities are, but they're not always necessary allotment per se, but community growing spaces. And certainly there's a lot of provisional spaces included in our local development, emerging local development plans. So again, it's just making sure that those on the waiting list are kept updated, so we don't sort of, they don't go stale on us and disappear, so that at least if they're not interested any longer, they still have that opportunity to tell us when we liaise with them and give them further information. Thank you.
I'm going to open up the next part of the question. One was around about, and Sinclair, I think you touched on it, around about what help is available for, I suppose, growing projects, community projects, in terms of the support, you know, in terms of funding, in terms of just, I suppose, that logistical help at the start if somebody's looking to take on an allotment or a community garden. What helps out there? And just in the same question, what more could Scottish Government do as part of that to help you in that regard? Sandy, I don't know if I want to touch open it with yourself, obviously, and I'll open it up again to probably Sinclair and open it up again. But.
Okay, thank you. I suppose the biggest contribution the Scottish Government could make would probably been touched on earlier on with the capital and revenue. However, there is the National Planning Framework and a greater consideration of food growing within the National Planning Framework. I fail to understand why developers are allowed to provide the size of garden that they are that offers no opportunity for a family to carry out food growing within their own premises. The regulations run about structures on allotment sites as well are particularly off-putting to many, many groups. An awful lot of growers come from, how would I put it, more of a holistic approach to growing, and it's more about nurturing soil, nurturing themselves and nurturing their families and their wider communities. And then you come up against the regulations of the systems that we have in place through local authorities and national government, and that can be difficult for many, many groups to navigate and very, very off-putting. Simplified processes, clear, simple planning regulations would certainly be a benefit, and of course the perennial issue of revenue funding available to maintain sites after the initial capital has been spent in setting them up. The revenue would contribute to officer resource being available to provide the support and facilitation and signposting that many of these groups encourage and welcome, and just might just be enough to get them from a point of inception to empowerment.
Andy, thanks for that. I don't know. Anybody else wants to come in on that one?
Sinclair wants to come in.
Yep, Sinclair.
Thank you. So in Aberdeen, when the Community Mound Act came out and we were developing our food growing strategy, we actually put £150,000 of capital in to help support communities bring forward community growing projects. I think we supported 30 projects. Some of those actually brought forward sites. Others were around skills and access to food and so on. So there has been a degree of capital and revenue support from the city here, but it is limited and it's not enough to meet the challenge that we have. And that's not criticism of Aberdeen City Council, that's just the revenue and capital situation that all local authorities, public bodies face at the moment and all the challenges they're trying to tackle. We do put some money into participatory budgeting as well and try and encourage communities to use that through our locality planning, etc. And we have a funding team who will support communities with any sorts of projects, including these sorts of projects, to access and navigate that funding landscape. We have community asset transfer process, and we do provide guidance and a bit of hand-holding around that, although, you know, that is complicated and scary for anyone who doesn't have the experience and skills around those sorts of issues. And we have community learning development and others who try and hand-hold through that process. Our environment services, who do the operational side of the land management, have, I would say, turned the ship around. So historically, we would have been a very traditional, we mow the grass, we plant trees, we provide an allotment site, and have really changed to a more community engagement approach on the back of legislation, but also on the back of just demand and available resources. Obviously, getting involved in this stuff provides huge benefits, and so supporting communities in that reduces the revenue burden on the council and provides those benefits to communities to access. So they have changed some of their structure to provide more community support and to provide access to land and do some hand-holding and that umbilical cord as well. So there is a range of support available out there. It's probably never enough, but it's certainly heading in the right direction and does provide more support for communities to access food growing opportunities.
Thanks, Sinclair. Anyone else?
Marina, what's good?
Marina?
Yeah, just on that, in terms of ongoing revenue, some of the case studies we have in our community food growing strategy highlight that in terms of open days, sales, and even extending to certain more cultural things in terms of music, etc., and art, to continue that flow of revenue, as well as the annual fees. Obviously, these are not council run, but the associations themselves, three associations, they have open days, and that is a means of increasing their revenue flow. But it's just for basic maintenance, and the council basically will ensure that the place is still fit for purpose and help out there. We do have a goodwill fund, and we also have a suite of community development officers in order to be able to help access other funding as well. Particularly in light of climate change, I think, and biodiversity is very important, that these things are not standalone, they're integrated, and they work best when they're working together. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, Pam.
Thanks. I'm aware, Amy, I don't want to put you on the spot, but I'm aware that you have to leave. So I just wanted to give you a little bit of space with not necessarily a particular question, in case there's anything you really want to make sure that we're aware of from your perspective in the Scottish Borders.
Thank you very much. Yeah, I was just about to say, I actually just completely concur with everything Sinclair said. There is some support available for community growers when they come to us and they get in touch and say that they want to start projects. The first thing I would do is to go and visit them, see their site, exactly, find out exactly what they're looking to do, and then work with the community engagement team to help them secure funding to get the projects up and running. The issue with that is that funding is usually quite a small plot of money, and that'll get them started. But after that, it's very difficult to, unless it's completely volunteer led, it's very difficult to for these projects to sustain themselves. And then on the bigger picture of providing more growing sites and more allotments, I had a meeting with the state, so it was really, really useful, where we looked at all their grazing lands and the grazing fields, at what could be available, and then started to research into how much it would cost to actually set up a new set of allotments. And we were looking in the region of between £40,000 and £70,000. And that is money that Scottish Borders Council do not have available for this type of agenda. And it's incredibly important that there is resources for us to be able to deliver, because we have this brilliant strategy and this brilliant legislation that encourages all to relook at the land we have and look at the provisions that we're making for the people that live within our constitutions. But if there's no revenue, then we are really struggling to provide the service that we're looking to do. And it's not like the enthusiasm's not there. The team that I work with are incredibly enthusiastic about providing allotment spaces and community growing projects across the Scottish Borders. It's just purely that there's a lack of financial there. And thank you so much for having me today. It's been a real experience for me. Thank you.
Thank you for joining us. It's been good to have your perspective. We're going to move on to the theme of local food growing strategies. And I know, Sinclair, you touched on it already quite a lot. I can have a general question around how has it been to create those strategies, if you have indeed, and I think both Aberdeen City Council and I think actually all councils have them that are represented today. But how has it been to create those, and how did you bring the allotments or the food growing spaces into those strategies and your thinking? And maybe I'll start with Sinclair, just to see if you've got any more to add on what you already said, and then I'll take it to Marina and then bring in Sandy.
Thank you. I would say it was a very positive experience for us. It really gave us the opportunity to widen out our thinking. So traditionally we had an allotments forum where we'd started to move to more devolved management of allotment sites across the city in the previous 10 years. Really part of that managing the resource available to us, but also empowering the communities to take more control and ownership of what was available to them. So this was building on that, but widening it out beyond allotments as well and bringing in things like It's Your Neighbourhood, Britain in Bloom and all these other elements. I'd say we got round the table with a diverse group. So we had allotment groups, we had council allotment officers and green space officers, we had Green Space Scotland, community growing groups and so on, and had some really, really interesting conversations. And I would say they drove really what our strategy looks like. It wasn't written by the council, it was facilitated by the council and coordinated by us. And that's probably why it focuses more on community growing, I would say, than allotments. Partly because at that time the allotments waiting list wasn't through the roof as it is now. Times have changed. I think we probably need to look again at the focus, and I think our reasonable measures are doing that, taking that shift from community growing back to allotments again to try and manage that waiting list. But having partners like CFINE, who are a whole food system, you know, regional partner, incredibly helpful. Having Green Space Scotland on board, who have a national picture and experience across a range of green space issues, was really helpful. And certainly CFINE are now embedded as a really strong partner in everything we do around food as a council, be that providing summer of play with food activities for schools to tackle food poverty, to supporting community growing organisations through a festival where everyone can get to meet each other and do stuff, taking on board the Food Grant Strategy Implementation Group, hosting the Sustainable Food Partnership, and so on. So all of these things have kind of catalysed around the Community Empowerment Act and that Sustainable Food Places approach. So on the whole, positive, really great for community growing, probably needs to take a slight refocus at the moment on allotments.
Thank you for that response. And I guess one of the things I gleaned from that, because I was starting to think, okay, so there's a strategy, but then what does it look like on the ground? But it's great to hear that you've actually got a food growing strategy implementation group. So it's not just something that sits in the digital dusty cupboard, but actually is having an impact on the ground. Marina, how's your food growing strategy?
Ours is actually doing quite well. We took the approach, it was... I work in development policy, so we had a development policy team plus others from development management, legal and community. So they covered all of the sort of people we wanted to engage with. So we had a group of stakeholders, and they included the community councils and the development trusts and any existing allotment associations and community gardens that we knew of. But obviously we didn't have the full picture. So it was really a very good exercise to find out where things were happening across Argyll. And certainly the community councils came into their own on that. In terms of the food growing strategy itself, we basically want to empower communities and empower individuals basically to join forces, because, you know, allotments don't happen just on the back of one individual. They happen, you know, they work best when there's a community involved. But we have a series of food festivals, and we also have Food from Argyll, which has been in existence long before the strategy, promoting Food from Argyll as well. But also the businesses and community groups that actually support that is a really good vehicle for encouraging people to add to that particular approach in terms of supporting the whole of Argyll. And the one thing I haven't actually mentioned is our 23 inhabited islands. And, you know, with our climate change and some of the fairies not playing ball in terms of weather conditions and whether they're full on the islands as well in terms of growing food. And a lot of them have adopted areas, sheltered areas, in order to be able to do that. So in particular, we have Isla and Colonsay and Tyree and Col. And of course, Mull as well. So we're very much in tune with, you know, having to have that sort of siege mentality as well, having enough in the store keep us going. So that's been settled into our culture. But as you say, we have worked across the board. But at the moment, I work with two other colleagues based in the asset transfer unit in estates, but also in legal. And we monitor what's happening in terms of our food strategy. But we're very well aware that it will need to be updated in the next few years, because we adopted ours in 2020. So in 2025, it will be updated. But we have been collecting further information. And one of the things I think that's actually hasn't really been mentioned is dealing with food security as well on a more local level. And certainly one of the groups in Oban run a Hope Kitchen, and they have an allotment within a food growing space within a walled garden in Oban itself. And they have been particularly successful in terms of getting funding, engaging with volunteers, having part, including an educational role as well, but also meeting the needs for those that are less fortunate as well. So, and certainly they've been quite creative in keeping their ongoing funding and making sure that they remain sustainable. And I think they're to be applauded on that level. Mm.
Thank you, Marina. Yes, I actually I visited Hope Kitchen and got taken to that fantastic garden, and it's just absolutely incredible to see what they're doing there. And I think also your comment about needing to update the food strategy. Of course, you know, at the moment, what's going through the Parliament is the Good Food Nation Bill, and that's going to have mm-hmm. another form of local authority plan around food, a good food plan. So probably there's going to need to be some thinking about how those two strategies work together. But Sandy, did you yes. want to come in uh-huh. and talk about your perspective of being on the kind of allotment side, and how did you kind of get involved if there is a Glasgow City food strategy?
Yes, there most certainly is a Glasgow food growing strategy. It was published in 2020, apologies. And since the publishment of the food growing strategy, which was developed through engaging with Green Space Scotland and Glasgow City Council, actually taking a stakeholder role in the process rather than a driver within it, it gave us an opportunity to hear, to listen to what our citizens were saying, and that then developed into the food growing strategy, which develops 16 high level actions so that the city can deliver more growing spaces and support growers, as detailed in the food growing strategy itself. It's from the allotment side of things, we will continue to work on our annual allotment reports. However, we understand that the food growing strategy supersedes the requirement for an allotment strategy per se, so that's perhaps where the confusion Peter had touched on earlier on had arisen from. We see the food growing strategy as a much wider conversation than the allotment conversation. The allotment conversation is very specific and very focused. The food growing strategy provides scope for a much broader range of food growing opportunities to be available to the citizens of the city. Not everyone wants to grow in an allotment, but some people find the allotment rules and regulations quite restrictive to the creative processes they apply. In community gardens, vertical growing, hydroponics, aquaponics, regenerative agriculture are all other approaches that are much sought after in Glasgow and certainly make a positive impact to our climate and ecological emergency declarations. It provides an opportunity for us to have a conversation around about soils and the health of those as well, and how they can actually help contribute to carbon sequestration from atmospheric CO2 into soil organic carbon. It can help with conversations around about health and well-being as well, and as much as we now have 5 GP surgeries in the Drumchapel area of Glasgow who refer through community link practitioners, citizens to the Growchapel site as a form of prescription almost, where gardening is provided as a form of stress reduction, gives people an opportunity just to reflect and take away the buzz of everyday life. It's also contributed to the development of the Glasgow City Food Plan, which looks at the whole food system, over 6 different themes. Food growing strategy contributes into the community side of that, and it's excellent to see the activation of private, public and third sector organisations coming together to develop that City Food Plan, which contributes to the overall city development frameworks as well. The 16 key actions of the food growing strategy are going to be summed up into 4 main themes, which is essentially increase growing spaces, increase and improve sources of information, support greater network and information sharing, and support policy and process improvements. And that's something that we're definitely going to be delivering from the food growing strategy. Sinclair touched on how they had an implementation group. We also have such a thing in Glasgow. It's the Glasgow Community Food Growers Forum, and they are monitoring the delivery of the food growing strategy, not only monitoring it, but actively participating in the delivery of the actions from that. And that's made up of a network of stakeholders from allotment associations, community gardens, and other forms of growing within the city as well, as well as the external officers group that we mentioned earlier on, that brings in other partners from NHS, local housing associations, health improvement coordinators, Police Scotland, and we also have our internal officers group that draw together internal officers, so the conversation is across the whole council and not just specifically within the parks development side of things.
That was very heartening to hear that so many different departments and groups and organisations are involved in that plan. I worked extensively in community food growing in New York City, and at that time, 20 years ago, there wasn't that level of awareness, that the understanding that everybody needs to get behind that, the kind of work we're doing, and the massive benefits it can bring to the city. Marie, you've got a few more questions you wanted to ask.
Thanks, Convener. Sandy, again, it's been touched on by others. How can local authorities help communities growing and allotments to thrive in areas of low kind of volunteering?
Yeah, it's a very difficult one to answer. And the one I touched on there would be around about the community links practitioners and the unique position that they have within local GP surgeries. I would understand there's a correlation between those who are termed as hard to reach and GP showing up at GP surgeries. The community link practitioners are ideally placed to start to open that conversation, to look at a person-centred approach to their health and well-being, to have that conversation around, have you ever considered food growing? Have you ever been part of an allotment? Have you went for a walk in a park? All these other benefits that we get indirectly from our open spaces. That's certainly one way of doing it. The other way that we try is raising awareness, continually talking with people, advocating, presentations to area partnership committees, presentations to our elected members, presentations to our community planning partnerships, attending conferences, raising awareness. In the areas of socio-economic disadvantage, you will find there is grassroots organisations. Drumchapel is a great example of that. Our site at Grow Chapel came about from the Quality of Life group that was chaired by Police Scotland, and they were finding people were dropping between the gaps between our health and social care partnerships and the criminal justice system. It wasn't a criminal behaviour, it was manifesting as criminal behaviour. You generally find there was a mental health issue at the back of that. It then led to an approach where we looked at an underutilised piece of open space within an area of socioeconomic disadvantage. We started an engagement process. There was a massive response in favour of developing it into a growing space. We've got 35 organisations, I believe, involved in Grow Chapel. Each one of those organisations has access to the site, and they bring in their user groups. Their user groups then get access to the site they might never have been aware of before. So that's one way. As I say, the raising awareness is another way. And as I say, the position of the community links practitioners within GP surgeries is also another way, where we can get to areas of low volunteering and encouraging people to kind of, even if it's not just volunteering. Volunteering comes secondary. Once you've got them to the point of educating them about growing and enthusing them with the benefits that growing can provide, you tend to find if they've got a fair bit of time available to them, they'll contribute that to the site.
Thank you. We were in Springburn yesterday, and it was amazing that we're just, you know,
yeah,
in the middle of the housing estate. But once you get into the allotment, you just didn't realise where you could be anywhere. Do you mean?
Absolutely.
I was quite chilled there, to be honest. I was going to move on. Sinclair, you've touched on this earlier again, but how can the planning system be better used to ensure adequate provision is made for new and existing community growers? Anything else you'd like to throw in there?
Thank you. Yes. If I can just touch on one thing from the previous point as well before I move on to that. So in Seafine, where they do food banks, they actually engage with those people who are coming with food insecurity, see if there's an opportunity for them to get involved in actually volunteering and growing their own food. So there's a bit of a kind of stepping stone approach to that. In terms of planning, a very interesting point, and certainly colleagues of mine have made clear that planning can probably do more. So historically, growing sites and green spaces are protected in local planning policy, probably not strongly enough. Now we are using, we're using mapping much more, partly through the Section 9 of this Act to provide a map for food growing potential. But we're now linking that up with the open space audits and strategies that come through the planning system as well. So I think there was a suggested link to bring together the mapping for food growing with the mapping for general green space across local authority areas, and we're doing that. There's a delay from the original food growing strategy to now because our open space audit wasn't done at the same time, but we've tweaked the way that we're doing that, and we're now looking at all of the land, publicly accessible land across Aberdeen over a certain size, and asking the question, what is the potential for that land to be used for food growing? Once we have that data, that we can then start drilling down and mapping that out a bit more and building that into our local development plan the next time around. It's not an immediate solution, but it is starting to build it much more into the planning process. It's been suggested by colleagues that possibly the Planning Act could do more to try and make the link between food growing and planning, and that while there's some things in there, open space as a whole is much stronger, play is much stronger, other things are much stronger than food itself. So perhaps there's an opportunity to look under the new framework as to how that could be strengthened. Historically, we've not had a huge success in actually bringing forward food growing sites through planning, which is disappointing, to say the least, and certainly in a period of significant growth for Aberdeen over the last 10, 15 years, to not have those sites is a missed opportunity. But like I've said, you know, if we can look again at how we manage that planning process and how we can manage things like local place plans and engage with communities to understand that there are opportunities that they can build into this around food and locality plans and so on to try and strengthen that approach that gets built into the next local development plan. It's all well and good putting it in policy. We also have to deliver it, and that means that our planners themselves need to be pushing developers and others to actually bring forward sites. And there's a bit of education there around our planners for development management, but also the developers to bring forward those sites within the planning process.
There as well, that maybe expand on where St Clair was, and it's just round about where developers are bringing forward growing sites. That perennial question round about maintenance and revenue after it's been handed over still remains. Consideration of that within any planning policies would be crucial, I would suggest.
Sandy, just taking back to the visits yesterday, I understand that Glasgow are going to add a further 250 yes. growing spaces. Correct me if I've got that figure wrong, but can you sort of expand on that? Maybe can you tell me how many are going to be traditional allotments and how many grown spaces?
Yeah, the 259 plots that we're looking to add through the iteration of this food growing strategy, we're looking at each electoral ward within the city, so that's 23 electoral wards that we're looking to adapt growing spaces within. Some of them will be on pre-existing sites where the space isn't utilised to its maximum efficiency. Some of them will be on new sites, and some of them will be in vacant and derelict land. Each of the growing formats that will be utilised would be determined essentially by the site that we develop. So if it's an allotment, it will generally be a traditional allotment site. If it's on vacant and derelict land and if there are contamination issues, it may very well be that it's a raised bed format, the accessible raised bed format. And if it's new sites, it will generally be traditional allotment format as well. But we're also looking at the mixture of more of a blend of the community aspects within allotments as well. Allotments, to a certain degree, have been siloed in as much as it's allotments is for individuals, but there isn't. There a community arises from that. There's a community of place there, a community of shared experience as well. And that leads to other developments of community. And while it might not be everybody's cup of tea to go to a 250-metre-squared plot, they might be looking for something a bit less restrictive, less rigid. There is space within allotment sites for that, and within the Grow Chapel site, which is a new site we've opened, there is certainly consideration of that. There is plots for individuals, there's plots for organisations, small starter plots, medium plots, larger plots, which allows a life cycle to develop. An introductory grower comes in, they start in a small plot, they prove their case there, they move up to a newer plot. That's also led to an increased demand in the city for urban farming as well, and that's something we're currently exploring with our economic development team and our partners in Glasgow Community Food Network. So we're also looking at vertical growing using technological solutions from an organisation called IGS, who have a research and development strand up at the James Hutton Institute in Invergowrie. There's a massive mosaic of different growing techniques that we're keen to explore in Glasgow and develop, so it will be a blend of all of those. It won't just be traditional allotments, it'll be community gardens, and it'll be technologically led innovations, as well as the regenerative agriculture approach in urban farming that we're looking at for the city too.
Thanks, Andy. That's me.
Thanks, Marie. And that brings us to the end of our questions and a very, very useful discussion. And I think that one of the things that's really come out, both in this panel but also this morning's earlier panel, for me, is this piece of let's get people started younger, and how can we really hardwire this into the education system so that, at the moment we're having to kind of, one of the things I'm hearing is people are faced with a large plot they don't really know what to do with, but they have that impulse. They know it's something that could bring them benefit. So if we can get that going in the schools, I think that would be more consistently. And I think one of the challenges I know from when I was working in the past, one of the challenges is summer holidays, when suddenly, you're at peak growing period and there's nobody there to water the vegetable plot. So anyway, thanks so much for joining us this morning. It has been very useful. And as that was the last public item on our agenda today, I now close the public meeting.